Welcome back. We got another series for you guys ready to go here. Team Archon versus Team Tempo Storm. And we got special guest Strifecrow with us today.
What
What do you
up,
think about
Kong?
the
What's up?
tournament so far? I mean, it's certainly a unique one, huh?
Oh yeah, it's unique. I love the format. I talked about it before, but it's definitely a cool format where you get to see your team. It's like, I know a lot of people have had like really high pressure moments, going like the 0-6 to 0-4, but it does build team synergy, and it definitely is a good format for a team league. So yeah.
I see
How's
it.
the
There you
Oh,
go.
go ahead, Chris.
All right. You say it builds team synergy. It certainly does so if you do well, but doesn't it break the team if you're like Trump right now?
I don't know. It depends, huh? It depends what kind of personalities you have in your team and how well you get together or get along. But I don't know. I mean, your team synergy, as in like you're more incentivized to practice together and things like that because you're working on different decks. You're really trying to specialize and you have to work with your team, right, to choose like the lineup. It's not as simple as like just going at it like solo, but I don't know. It's cool.
How's the dynamic with Cloud9 recently? Because you guys didn't take your first match, but it seems like you guys still put up a pretty good fight.
I don't know. We never talked after.
All right. Well, people were hoping
Team
you guys do
broken.
well, but we'll
Team
talk
broken.
about
No,
that.
it's more. No, I don't know. We didn't really have any issues with losing or whatever. It's whatever. More like people start traveling. Clinto into China after. It's kind of a lot of. It's kind of a bad thing, I guess. But we didn't really have a lot of ways to, practice together or talk too much about it. But it should be okay still. I mean, no one, I don't think anyone's mad, at least. I don't know.
It's all
No, I
good,
hope so.
Strifecrow. Don't
Yeah,
worry. You
it's
can
all good.
get your rage out tomorrow when you play.
Yeah.
In the meantime, taking a look at the lineups, or not, we can go right back to us. Oh no, we're back. We got Firebat, Zalay, and Sixo from Team Archon up against Hypegar and Eloise from Tempo Storm. And last week, both of these teams end up dropping their series, so one of them will get their first wins today.
As far as the class lineups, pretty standard schmandard from here, Team Archon. They're basically putting in flavor with Mage, I guess, which isn't much. And Tempo Storm are bringing also the Mage, but instead of the Druid, they got the Priest. Again, this is also the other version of the Priest. We saw Dog play the Deathlord anti-aggro priest in the last tournament that Garra played in the HTC. Garra brought the Control-ish priest, and his priest was also undefeated in that tournament. So not much of a surprise for that. It seems like priest is maybe a little bit under the radar right now against this field. How do you feel about that, Strifecrow?
I guess priest. I don't know. Priest is like a class with very high variance, right? It's like really good against decks that fight you for board control, or like I guess like tempo based minion decks, and it's like really bad against combo decks sometimes, or Rogue and Handlock, I guess I'm mostly thinking of, just because you don't really have an answer to Draxxus, and you can't really pressure Patron War, so they can pretty much just one shot you at some point, so I don't know. It's like a really polarized. I don't know exactly. It's not really like you're really incentivized to do anything special in a conquest format. Like if it's really polarized, it doesn't really make a difference whether it's just really good, really bad, or really overall. It's just more about the average. So it's okay to bring priests, I feel, if you want to. Otherwise, not mandatory either. So.
All right. Well, we'll see what the players have in store coming up. But before we do that, we have a quick video on Firebat to get to know him a little bit better.
Hello, my name is Firebat, and I'm a player for Team Archon. But no, these are good. They're really good. The whole interview. Come on. As a Hearthstone player, I think I'm most known for winning the BlizzCon World Championships in 2014. I think the format of the team league is great, and I really think that our team is going to excel. We've been working really hard. We got a lot of great players, a lot of up-and-comers, and I think this is just really going to be spectacular for us. I think the strongest deck at the moment is Patron Warrior, and I think there's a lot of soft counters, but no real like hard counter. Nothing that just outright stomps it that's really kind of good against other things. So that's what makes it such a strong deck. To my fans supporting me in the league, I want to say you guys are awesome, and I'm going to make you guys proud.
His great accessories that he has, and, you know, with the glasses and everything. Actually, Crip was asking whether or not those were 3D glasses or those were actual functional glasses. We have no idea. So let us know your thoughts, whether on this match or on Firebat's glasses, by hashtagging ATLC on Twitter. Not? Yeah, why not? Guys, any predictions for this match before we begin?
These are like the two teams that, you know, are really trying to make an effort with like their webs. They're trying to like get a little bit into everything. So I think these are like maybe the try hard teams of the tournament. Even though I think there was a few things said from Templestorm that they didn't prepare as well as they should have. This is week two. Maybe that's changed.
Well, you know, we can go ahead and play up the drama a little bit more. I mean, there's obviously some bad blood between Templestorm and Archon just from the rivalries. We start off Warrior vs. Warrior with Zalaver's hyped here.
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily from these players individually, but it primarily stems from the owners. Amaz and Reynad have publicly been on record of just, you know, taking little shots here and there at each other.
Yeah.
And, you know, generally speaking, it creates this rivalry inherently through the player's inheritance, right? It's like they want to defend the honor of, you know, Ray Noodle or, you know, Amaz Arena. So in this case, we're going to see who's going to take the better of it today, because remember, they only play once during the regular season. So whoever wins this gets not only a win on the count there, but also a decisive win the overall, because they won't be playing for the rest of the league unless they get to the playoffs.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man. Hype looks pretty sleepy. That's the sleepiest I've seen Hype look.
I don't actually know. Hype told me that there's some stuff that he was doing. He's been really busy in his personal life, so that's why he hasn't been able to like stream and mm-hmm. and maybe even practice as much as he has been able to. But seems like he's starting to come onto it okay in July. He feels like maybe he can start getting back on track. So right. Looks like he's gotten the Control Warrior here up against. Well, I expect Zlay to play Patron Warrior.
Yeah, he has to be playing that that Shield Block Patron Warrior. He played in the last few tournaments, he showed Warrior in. He's doing very well on ladder with that deck. So I don't think we'll see too much of a surprise from Zele. It's mostly Hype. Hype usually likes to tech a few cards in the standard decks and do well with the changes.
So how is the Patron Warrior versus Control Warrior matchup nowadays, Strife Crew? I think people were really saying that Control Warrior had a strong edge. Has it gotten any better at all for Patron, or even better for Control Warrior now that they learned the matchup more?
I think actually, I mean, I still think Control Warrior is favored, but Patron Warrior gets better with skill, I feel, in the matchup. Like, if you don't know what you're doing at all in that matchup, you'll probably almost never win, you know, just because, like, you really need to play that matchup pretty precise. Like, you have very limited ways to win, and you really need to go for those options. Whereas Control Warrior, it's easier to kind of just play anything and win, you know? So as you're playing Patron Warrior, it feels harder. I don't really know if it's due to deck lists or anything like that. A lot of Patron Warriors are in Harrison Jones, which helps. Whereas Control Warriors were kind of always were using Harrison Jones. But I don't know, I still think it's pretty heavily control favored, so.
Mm-hmm.
I'm actually kind of curious how you guys are watching the game. Like, I don't see anything.
Watch it from. Okay. It's on. You're not getting the screen share. Okay, well, we can.
Oh, okay. That's screen share. Oops. I'll look at it.
Oh, were you watching the stream?
And no, like, I was not looking at anything.
Okay.
All right. It seems like it is Control versus Patron. It seems like both players have great hands. Now, often in some matchups, that has some issues where, like, if one deck just draws well, it doesn't matter how well the other one draws. I feel like Patron Warrior is kind of like that, but I don't know if it's quite like on that stage of good draw. Like it seems like a good draw, but it's maybe a bit slow. And I think you need the Frothing combo to really win. I don't think the Grim Patron really does enough against the Control Warrior.
Yeah, it's a really good analysis. The Grim Patron oftentimes can't win by itself because there's so many ways for a warrior to deal with it. And Brawl is just such a big threat to destroy your entire board that you've worked so hard to build. You can invest 3 or 4 cards into a Whirlwind, Inner Rage, Grim Patron, Warsong, and then he Brawls and then removes whatever comes out. So
yeah.
It's very difficult to use that as your primary win condition, but it's still, you know, a decent amount of pressure. Sometimes this matchup can go to fatigue-ish areas. If the Control Warrior, like maybe the Patron decks out, and then the Warrior's on like this last 7 or 8 cards,
mm-hmm.
And the Warrior doesn't draw the threats, and then the Patron becomes the only way you can win. But those situations are very rare. So you're absolutely right, Griff. I think the Frothing Berserkers will be the key.
Yeah, you absolutely need to get gigantic Frothing Berserker value. Your only other way to win is something like a huge Patron combo and them not having the answer, like no Brawl or something. Mm-hmm. I mean, I feel like most of the ways that Patron War does win would involve Emperor. So it's really nice that he has Emperor. It's really hard to get anything going without Emperor in this deck. Like a lot of times, like we see in the last match, the games can just stall out really late if you don't see Emperor, because without the mana reduction, you can't really get any crazy turns. Like, oftentimes, the turns aren't good enough or you're just not doing anything at that point, mm-hmm. So...
Well, it's pretty funny that basically the only thing in the deck that Hype could play to deny Zele from playing Emperor would be his own Emperor. So not only is it, like, a good coin Emperor, but it actually denies Zele's.
Yeah, funny how that works. Or it's able to control the state of the board by playing the exact same card. Now, interestingly enough, Zele is a Patron Warrior specialist. He's grinded this deck to top ends of Legend. Like, I think he was holding number 1 on NA, and he was number 2 on EU at the same time, playing Patron only. And yet last week, from what I've heard, I think there were some disagreements on how Zele played this Patron Warrior, even though I consider him the specialist. Within the Archon team, some people were thinking maybe he was a little bit more like he wasn't doing the right plays, or he was being a little too conservative or too aggressive, and so I wonder if he's able to fix that.
I think it's just the nature of the deck that this skill cap is so insane. Even being at the top of your game, sometimes just you don't have that extra 1 second in the turn. Like
there's a lot of pressure too in the tournaments. Like even if you're normally a very good Patron player, you can easily mess up because these tournaments are pretty high pressure, and Patron War is such a hard deck to play. So,
yeah, in the HTC tournament, I believe Zele missed an attack with the Patron because his turn just ended, and then he was like 3 off lethal the next turn, but he actually had lethal, but it was just like a really like difficult to see lethal, so he didn't see the lethal. He lost RNG on the Sylvanas, and then he was 1 off lethal and he ended up losing that game.
That's really unfortunate. My heart breaks just hearing that a little bit, it's like he was basically there, but he missed the last attack.
Yeah,
it was a little bit too slow.
All right, well, you have the Brawl here. It's just, if one of the Patrons stay alive, then it multiplies immediately, because the ghoul dies.
Yeah, you can
dies.
Actually kill the ghoul first. It doesn't really matter, right, if you kill it first, I guess. But it's kind of hard to kill, because you probably want your Shredder alive as well, and there's not an easy way to kill the ghoul. I like the decision to go for Patron, though. Like, you don't really need to save Patron for combo. You really need to save just the Frothing stuff for combo. And you kind of want to, like, just check if they have Brawl. And oftentimes they only run one Brawl, so it's nice to get it out of the way. I just like him going for the Patron. Mm-hmm. I think Zele will probably... Oh, wow. It doesn't clear here? I would think for sure this is going to be a Brawl. What
now? I don't know. I like to see some Boombot RNG though, so I'm okay with this.
Okay.
Oh, he pushes into it.
Mm-hmm.
Huh.
Interesting.
I'm really curious too. Nat Pagel.
Oh, wow. So that didn't go too well.
And he didn't get to attack with the micro machine either.
Yeah, but if he had a frothing here, that's game over, right?
Yes. Yes, certainly.
Certainly.
With a high amount of certainty, yeah. I think he would die. 18 damage right now. 21. 20.
You know, I wonder if there's lethal here. I'm very this, but
hold on.
I wouldn't be surprised if there was
lethal. There is lethal. There is lethal.
Yeah, you just whirlwind and fire war axe. You have to kill on board, right?
But you can get more patrons, like with the unstable ghoul, I think.
Oh, wait,
after
you're right.
Some
you're
of them die to whirlwind. Like, yeah. You don't have space, exactly. Right? So you can't double the patrons.
No, it is lethal with that. Yeah. It is lethal with that. Isn't it? I think it is.
Yeah, you whirlwind and then you unstable ghoul. Yeah. And he should have enough time.
You need to use both whirlwind effects for sure, because you need to clear out some of the patrons of the first whirlwind effect so you can whirlwind again.
Uh-oh, wait. Guys.
Is everyone getting in here?
Oh, no time. Wait, is there time?
Wait. Hold on. You might have queued it up.
Is everyone really, really getting in here?
Oh! No! He missed the impact.
No! It happened again.
Oh!
And you can't blame him for that. That's not his fault. It's ridiculous.
His fault, but it's so hard to do, you know.
Yeah,
it's
come
not,
on.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
It and takes forever. Kill off whatever I think out. You need to think very fast, right? Because that's not exactly easy. You need to stagger your rolling effects where your first rolling effect kills off some of the minions so that your second rolling effects can spawn more patrons. It's
There's probably that guy in chat right now. It's like he's just going over to Zelly stream, like unfollowed, unsubscribed.
Wow. And the weird thing is,
he can stabilize.
Lose. Yeah, exactly. With the shield slam, with the shield block here, clear the board, there's nothing left. I mean, I don't know who's going to win, but it's definitely either way at this point.
Yeah.
Wow.
So the strategy is Emperor Thorsten hits face a bunch of times for him to win.
Yeah.
Well, at least once, but I'm not sure if Hype will even allow it to happen because he has
so much. Is a Grom and execute worst case scenario, which is weird because you're executing a 5-1, but it's might happen.
Yeah.
He goes for the Grom execute. If you shield block here to dig for something, if you don't hit anything, then you can't kill the Emperor. So he just decided to play it. I don't know if this is safer or more risky, but it's another line.
Okay. If Zalay gets Gromosh, though, it's lethal.
Yeah.
There is still lethal if he slams into... Oh, no, he can't, because he can't slam and play the Warsong Commander.
Yep. Oh! Wow.
Damage.
Is that enough, though? Because he only does 8 damage with this Dead Spite, and his opponent will have shield block number 2.
It probably won't be enough as far as, unless he gets another...
He's 1 damage off lethal!
If he has another Warsong, he can win next turn. Warsong Commander, if he gets his 2 whirlwinds.
Oh man, wow. Sludge Belcher.
That's really good.
Oh my god!
Hyped does decide to not play Armorsmith here. The Armorsmith could have maybe threatened more armor in a way than just armoring up.
Yeah, because maybe he wanted less minions.
That's true. But,
okay. Well, I think it's time for everyone to get in here and just go for it.
Wow. You have to go for it, right? Double. You have 2 whirlwind effects here. You don't even need to execute.
Yeah.
But now it's Straza.
Yeah, Alex Straza on yourself, and then you execute one of the patrons. This is still, like we said,
this is like... execute this 1-1 here? Because the 1-1's threatening one of your 3-1s. That's pretty inefficient in a way, but does feel like it's pretty all-in.
Against a deck like this, it's really hard to make that call.
Yeah.
Because there's so many big threats coming out of the control warrior.
Yeah, that's an interesting idea. Like, I didn't really think about that, but the more that I do, it's like you have one card left. Controlery has five. Mm-hmm. You know what? You're obviously all in right now.
You're obviously all in.
So yeah,
I have two patrons left actually, after Alex draws like, execute.
Yeah, I kind of like the execute on the taunt.
What now?
Is Hype thinking of another move here? It seems like Alex draws that. Oh,
he's thinking of Sludge Belcher.
Oh, yeah, I think Sludge Belcher.
I see.
Because
that's a little bit more risky against than Alexstrasza, because of it. Now he has Armor Smith down and this Belcher. So I mean, if this Belcher dies, there's a chance that these patrons get duplicated.
Oh, that can get out of control.
Yeah, there's no answer other than, you know, Ragnaros to try to snipe.
Yeah, and now he Zelay does kind of. There's no War Song, so it's not that bad. But you still get another patron, and your frothing's growing, so might come down to YOLO Rag.
Does he survive if he just leaves it on board? There's 12. Yeah, he'll actually be okay, hypothetically speaking.
If you just Alex yourself.
No, if you Ragnaros.
If you Ragnaros, if you kill off a minion, Hypothetic like, should be okay. But then the Grim Patriot can still copy itself.
Exactly.
Well, what if you suicide the Armorsmith?
Hmm.
Oh, that's an interesting thought.
Oh my god. But that's not really good, is it?
The execute is really good. No, it's actually useless here, I think.
No, you just have to suicide the Grim Patron, that's it.
Suicide the Grim Patron?
Yeah.
That's a kind of a hard call to make, too, when there's Armorsmith up.
Wouldn't you want to just copy the Grim Patron, though, so it's more targets against Ragnaros and push?
Hmm.
It does seem to me there's no way you can trade Frothing for Rag. I feel like you have to hope that Rag just misses. Like, you can't trade for Armorsmith and then get a 9-4 Frothing and trade for Rag. You have to go face after that. I guess the question is, can you trade for the 3-3 and execute Rag? Right, but I don't think so. I think you have to YOLO this.
Oh, man.
It's probably not worth executing the 1-1. In fact, the 1-1's kind of even a liability.
Yeah. Shield Maid.
I don't think that's useful because Alexstrasza is just better at this point because it's healing for 14. It's not like you can do anything special with the Shield Maid. It'll be good eventually.
So it still needs to hit that Frothing, otherwise the same cycle will repeat over and over. This Frothing's getting stronger.
Battle Rage! Exactly what
you need here. Okay, 13 damage. His opponent's at 21. A whirlwind is still not enough, right?
Yeah, those cards kind of suck.
Oh man, we're getting hyped for nothing.
Yeah, this is the last turn. Your Frothing is going to stay alive here.
Right.
Unless you just execute Alexstrasza. Because now you have some other small minions that might absorb the rag shot. Also, your face might absorb rag. So it's possible that you can just execute Alexstrasza and try to keep your Frothing alive longer.
Mm-hmm. Dude, that Frothing did so much damage. Are you kidding me?
It's not enough for control where it can take it, man.
Yeah. Death Spite.
Yeah, Death Spite plus Shield Maiden allows him to help stabilize.
Yeah,
the board.
I guess Zelay wasn't too scared about the Alex trading into the Frothing. I mean, that doesn't look that bad. You still kill Alex this way as well.
Why did he do that first?
Realistically, there's no difference because
but if you top deck a Shield Slam and it's like, I don't know, grow magic.
But you're not gonna have armor next turn either, right?
Yeah, if you put 5, you're still
because there's more than 5 damage on board, anyways.
Okay,
but for the most part, it's probably a small thing.
No, you could if Ragnaros kills the Delphian.
Oh, that's true.
Alright, hits the face. Well, Inner Rage helps.
That is the place.
It's really good, actually, the Inner Rage, because it's a free card. Like, you could just Inner Rage your Acolyte of Pain and get the two extra damage. And it replaces itself.
Battle Rage!
Oh, wow.
Whoa. Keep in mind that this game was supposed to be Zalaze a while ago. Yeah. This game is gone.
There's no way that this patron gets duplicated anymore, unfortunately. Wow.
Is that lethal?
I think seven, it is.
7 plus 9 slam is 10.
Well, the Armorsmith is 2 damage, remember?
The Armorsmith is 2, 4, 5.
It's 11 damage, I think.
10. 11. It is 11 because of the slam. It's one off. Wow.
He's out of cards too, so he has no more ways to kill his opponent after this.
You have to go for it. The best move is to...
It's 11.
Oh, he can't kill off Rag either unless he suicides minions. Oh my goodness, he's one damage off, and I mean, Hype still has to control the state of the board here.
Wow, it's over though. Hype can't win anymore.
No, he can big game Hunter the Frothing Berserker.
Oh, you're right. So wait, I thought Zalay had a Death Spite equipped, but he doesn't. That's Hype.
No, so he hits the Acolyte. And then hits the face.
No. He Death Bites the 2-3 to fatigue the Acolyte twice.
But he
and then 5-4 into Acolyte. And then Big Game Hunter on the Frothing. That's the play.
Honestly, it should be irrelevant, though, whether you fatigue twice or not, because once the other person's out of cards, they won't be able to kill you. It doesn't actually matter, unless you're trying to race with fatigue damage. But...
Hype lives with 1 HP multiple turns in a row.
No! Okay, yeah. Alright.
And then he can't actually kill
control. No, he can't win, because you can armor up every turn, even if Rag misses, right? Even if Rag goes face, it doesn't matter, because you have three, and that last card's an execute, so there's no way that...
I guess Hype knows that's an execute.
Right, because he's seen only one throughout the game.
That's why I left not
oh my god, that is so brutal.
Wow.
Oh, he missed the lethal by 3 damage because of the timer, and then ended up being multiple turns 1 damage off the rest of those games.
Zalay's only way to win now is to hope that Hype fatigues out, which is not even close, so...
Yeah, and Hype can't actually even guarantee kill him. He might want to kill him, but... Oh no, it's fatigue damage. Never mind.
Yeah.
Should be enough.
Yep.
All right. Well, what an crazy way.
It happened again. Didn't this happen last week?
This happened in Zele's last tournament.
Yeah, exactly.
He played Patron. He played it better than what the casters could come up with.
Yeah.
But still, ran out of time, and it cost them to miss lethal, and then he got reversed. And I actually think in the other game, it was also against the control warrior.
Was it?
I think so. It was a warrior.
I think you're right. I think it was against the control warrior. I actually kind of remember this situation.
That's crushed, man. Good. Totally crushed.
I feel it.
Now, if you're trying to manage some team spirit, you would not send Zalay out there, right?
I don't know. No. Maybe he wanted to redeem himself immediately. But then the problem is if he loses again, then he gets benched and you start becoming, cornered based off your lineup.
Yeah, it feels like the bench rule is kind of a rule that really mixes it up so you don't just random dice roll whoever you send out. If you're the loser, you kind of want to send someone who didn't just lose. And that makes it so, you see a lot more variety. I think it actually spices up the tournament a lot, and it's pretty funny how some small adjustments in the rules or in the cards can have such a big impact on Hearthstone tournaments.
Yeah, absolutely. Not really sure what will come out here from either team here. I'm just kind of keeping track of my own notes. Now that the control warrior is out of the way, though, that's probably a sigh of relief, because I think Temple Storm last week had control warrior lose very early, and then there was a situation where it just never felt like the right time because of Druid always being looming. And then they couldn't necessarily queue up Warrior confidently without taking the loss here. And more importantly, it took Temple Storm 6 games to get their first win last week. So this time around, they start off strong getting the first win because they were down 0-5 to start off the series.
Yeah. Well, we'll have to see what happens here.
I imagine it seems like teams are also gravitating towards Freeze Mage early on in the series. Mm-hmm. I think because, yeah, especially now that Control Warrior is out of the way, if Firebat's playing Freeze Mage, I think he should go for it.
I think Freeze Mage is just generally pretty good.
Yeah, and then the worst matchup possible, like the 95%+ chance that you beat. Well, maybe better now that Emperor Thorazine's out, but Freeze Mage worst counter is out of the way, so I feel like Archon might queue it up.
What I haven't seen in a long time is a Freeze Mage mirror, however, and I'm hoping we maybe get a chance today.
It's definitely a fun matchup, actually. I guess a lot of people would disagree, but there is a lot of skill in Freeze Mage mirror. So.
Yeah. Well, talk to us about that.
Talk to us about Freeze Mage mirror? I guess a lot of it was one thing I know from playing Freeze Mage a decent amount recently is you kind of want to count cards to see who has more cards left in their deck. Like, a lot of times what happens is, like, one person is clearly going through their deck much faster than the other person, you know, more efficient acolytes or whatever, and it's usually the person that goes through faster is the all-in person. So, like, the big thing about this matchup is who to Alex Straza, right? Because there's both ways. Some people say either way. Right. But I think one thing is maybe whoever goes through a deck faster should be the one Alex Straza-ing offensively. Because once you get to the end of your deck, your ice block becomes worthless and you just die the next turn if they ever get you to one. So if you're fatiguing first, it means that you should probably try to kill them first and offensive Alex Straza instead. Also, I think like whoever just plays like Alex Straza first is good in a way, just because the 8-8 is a lot of times like you're using your Frostos and Blizzards and Flame Strikes just on empty board just because you need to get rid of them in your hand, and then the 8-8 comes out, it's actually a little bit hard to deal with as well. Mm-hmm. But I'm not sure. It's a fun matchup, just to always like counting cards in everyone's hand, try to there's like weird Acolyte of Pain situations as well where you can, if you do ping it, you'll overdraw, but if you don't ping it, you don't have enough cards because then they one-shot it, so it's like you're at like 7 or 8, you know? So it's like, you don't want to draw 3, but you don't want to draw 1 either. It's really weird, yeah.
Yep. Fun stuff.
The answer good enough for you, Crip?
It's good enough. It's yeah. A+, man, A+.
Sounds like we don't have to cast the rest of the match.
I think we're done.
Yeah. Shrekos dropped the mic out of the building.
I'm excited for Tempo Storm Elois playing.
Not you too, Strife.
Who's that?
Of course.
Not you too. so we've cool. removed Strife Crow from the cast due to offenses.
What? Where's my offense?
Oh, wait, you actually think that's how you say her name? It's Eloise Strife
Crow. Oh, oops.
I thought it was Eloise.
Yeah, well, you get the general intonation correct, but
okay.
Well, Chef Crow actually doesn't know, but last week we were just playing
Vanish, Prep Vanish.
I'm Prep Vanish. That confused I'm, with I'm vanishing right now.
yeah. The last week, someone got her name wrong too. Kept calling her E. Lewis.
E. Lewis. Okay. Yeah. Sure. Hmm? Well, it looks like we're struggling to find our next match. There's probably there's a bit of a technical issue going on that's hopefully going to be resolved pretty soon. And we should have some matches for you guys then. As far as the players, as far as the teams, I mean, we didn't quite go over how these teams did in the last week. I believe both these teams have lost their opening game. I don't remember exactly who they were matched up against, but I do know that Archon is like first place in the loser bracket, where they're like they lost, but they got 5 points on the board. And I believe Tempo Storm is third place, tied for second place in the loser's bracket, I guess, where they lost, but they got 4 points on the board.
Yeah. Basically, if you have a tied record, tiebreakers go to those who win more games in their individual series. So even though a team might be 3-4, you know, they might have 20 wins versus, or I don't know, like an opponent might be like 3-4, but one only like, you know, 18 wins or something. Mm-hmm. All right, let's go into game number two. I think looks like the technical issues on Eloise's point of view. And, yeah. Looks like she had to restart her computer or something like that. That's what we got information. Sixo's playing, I believe, from Korea. He was chilling out in the, I think, the OGN studios and doing some work over there with fellow teammate Orange as well as Kalento. So he's dedicated. He really wants to play this match. Freeze Mage versus Rogue.
Yeah, that is a pretty interesting one. I think this one is quite favored on the Freeze Mage end of things. At least whenever there's a highlight, it seems the Freeze Mage crushes. But the Rogue has a chance. It's certainly no Paladin matchup.
Interesting.
Yeah, this matchup is very, I guess, standard for Freeze Mage. Usually you just try to draw early, you know, control the board mid-game, and then you just, like, Alex draws and try to burn them out. It's very racy, what I feel, because neither player can really last forever in this matchup. Rogue has so much weapon damage and just damage overall, so I think from the Rogue perspective, it is important to really try to rush down the block as soon as possible, because oftentimes, like, the mage will have enough damage to kill you. You don't have a lot of healing as the Rogue player, but if you can force, like, high enough tempo moves where, you know, like, say you get the ice block before Alexstrasza, like, then can't Alexstrasza you. They have to replay the block. It's hard to play both in the same turn. Like, you really need to just force that dynamic, so.
Okay. Whoa, what's that?
Wow, sheep.
That's an explosive sheep.
I have not seen that card in a while. Card,
but not incredibly rare in Freeze Mage.
I feel this was a card that was teched into the Freeze Mage deck at the start of GVG because of the dominance of Mech Mage and the fact that you could punish Mirror Entity not only with Doomsayer but with the Sheep as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's less minion-based decks recently and more combo-based decks or control, so the Sheep hasn't been super popular. I wonder what card is cut for Sheep. It could be like a heal bot. I think that slot is fairly flexible.
I actually really like the heal bot. I think it makes the hunter matchup a lot better, doesn't it?
Yeah, it helps a ton in that matchup. Seems like there's too many cards, so maybe explosive sheep. I mean, I don't think you can exactly just continue drawing here because too many cards in your hand.
Well, what do you think could just drop in the Doomsayer and pinging off the 1-1? Do you want to save that for a bigger turn?
I think
the
Doomsayer is more important than the Sheep, because Sheep really can only clear a very limited amount of things, whereas Doomsayer can clear everything. And a big thing about Doomsayer isn't even the fact that it clears everything. Like, it's much better to clear a board with Frostnova Doomsayer or Blizzard Doomsayer than it is with Flamestrike or any other burn like that, just because of the sense that you buy another turn. Mm-hmm. If they can't clear Doomsayer, they can't play any minions the next turn as well. So,
I feel like every time I see this matchup, Doomsayer is the one eating the sap, though. So, I don't know.
Yeah, that's something that's certainly a concern, because that's the way Rogue can deal with Doomsayer the most efficiently while keeping their board. Kind of like their version of the Owl. Mm-hmm. But sapping a Doomsayer is usually beneficial for Rogue if they can push for it, and if Freeze Mage doesn't have a follow-up freeze. But sometimes they do. They can play, like, Doomsayer, and then you sap and they have another freeze to follow it up, which sucks.
Yeah. All right. Well, what do we do here? Looks like we're sprinting, right? If we're sprinting, we have to play something, I believe, because we're going to be on 10 cards after the sprint is cast.
Yeah, probably the Auto Barber.
Yeah,
lacks a better response.
Yeah, it seems like a good option here.
That's a cool card too, by the way. The Auto Barber is something that was really good teched in to defeat Zoo, because it felt like Zoo just had a little too much health and one weapon daggers were not getting accomplished anything. You could take out the knife jugglers, you can take out the flame imps, and be able to, like, you know, take out Direwolf Alphas and whatnot. But then Zoo started building a little more mid range and less, like, small minion intensive, and then
then
you have Void Caller. So
yeah, not as many.
Auto Barber doesn't do anything against that.
Not as many threatening minions, but minions are much harder to remove.
it's really good in this matchup too, just because it's like another high damage minion that they have to deal with. And usually if they're using Auto Barber, it probably means that they're using Assassin's Blade as well. But overall, it's not looking very good for Rogue, just because this matchup, like, turns is like one of your most important resources as the Rogue player. And like, if both players have 10 cards in their hand, like in this situation, Rogue hasn't done much damage here, you're probably going to lose, because Freeze Mage is better at being non-interactive than you are. You know, like, if you're both doing your thing this lane game, they'll probably win, just because, you know, at that point they can just Alexstrasza you and kill you, right? And they can hold on just with cycling turns with Ice Block or something like that, right? Or like Frost Novas and Flame Strikes. So it's looking really bad for Rogue. There's already Alexstrasza in hand, and combine that with Pyroblast, that's already threatening you all the way down to 5 life, right? And yeah, that's right, assuming that there's no Fireball or Frostbolt top deck in the next like 5 turns. So
yeah, she also has Antonitis, so there's ways to convert damage as well.
Exactly. I feel like 6-0 needs to get some healing soon, or to try to pressure enough where Eloise cannot play Ice Block and Alexstrasza.
Which
is going to be pretty hard because it's coming down soon already.
All right. Well, Eloise, I think, really just wanted to remove some cards from her hand, because there is not like too many like very active plays that you have on that turn.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, she can kill the Doomsayer and make sure to remove it off the board. But it's like you said, how do you actually make sure that you can pressure beyond that?
And this is one of the reasons why Doomsayer is really good. It's not as consistent against Rogue just because of sap and all the damage. But if you do get a Doomsayer off here, it's much better than just a normal board clear, because a Doomsayer buys you another turn where they can't drop minions. This is perfect because then you Alexstrasza an empty board, but...
Right. In this case, it's also somewhat humorous, because now you give back a Doomsayer, and then you can Flame Strike and not have to worry too much about the board.
Mm-hmm. Oh, because so
that weapon. that weapon is insane. It's going to be a 10 damage weapon soon.
Yeah, well, this is the pressure that he really needed to get, and it's happening.
She just needs to buy a couple turns while being able to play Alexstrasza. It seems a little bit hard to do, though. I mean, there's a Flame Strike here, and the weapon is still up, but there's no more minion damage. Then if you can just find a turn to play Alexstrasza and Ice Block somehow.
Hmm.
If you're a true yellower, you can coin Alexstrasza and hope you don't die. I think you're in a very good position, though, so I wouldn't do something drastic like coin Alexstrasza and hope you don't die.
Alright. All right, well, it's gonna either force some heat off of it.
Oh! Assassin's Blade's in the deck. That's right, because that's paired up with the Goblin Auto Barbers, right?
Yeah.
So whenever you have Goblin Auto Barbers, you run Assassin's Blade. And that makes this investment kind of like feel bad, man.
Wow. Right. Glothib and the Healbot, two mega draws in this matchup.
He's also got major damage too right now.
Yeah, a lot of times you want to save Lothab for after Alexstrasza. You don't want to Lothab and then the Alexstrasza on the same turn, because then they can spend all their mana. But I wonder if you can count lethal, you know, if you just Lothab this turn and then attack. Like, if you do get Alexstrasza, I wonder if you have lethal next turn anyways.
And the race is like, what?
Oh, well, she has Alexstrasza, and she also has Ice Block, Emperor Thorzin to make things cheaper, and then end up converting the damage.
Fairly straightforward turn. The way 6-0 play, it's a very forcing move, but it doesn't really demand answers, right? Because there's nothing on board, so you just Ice Block and Emperor here, especially with this draw. And at this point, it's more of a game of solitaire. There's not many decisions on either player's part after this move, like 6-0's forcing move. 6-0 has the Lothab and Healbot, very good cards. But then again, the Alexstrasza into cheap spells is also good. It seems like Sixo is one turn ahead on the race, though, so.
I wonder.
Yeah, I feel like Sixo's in a position where he can threaten to pop the ice
Wait,
block.
Wait, no, is that lethal?
No, no, there's ice
can
block.
Can you get the block here, actually? That's really important. You can get him to one, I think. The answer might be no.
Yeah, the answer is no.
Wow. Yes, 17 with the Assassin's Blade hit and the Eviscerate, right?
Yeah.
That's actually extremely important that Dice Block is not procced here, because it buys you a turn where you can Alex Draza your opponent and not have to worry about dying the next turn, and then you can easily threaten 15. But 6-0 does have the double 5 drops to counter Alex Draza. Another Ice Block.
Second Ice Block.
That is a really big draw, because after you get Lothed with Ice Block, Yeah, you can still buy a turn after.
Yeah, you can buy one more turn.
And that
I
makes it so you can actually
play your
win.
Acolyte here over a ping.
No, I think you can do Antoninus or Alistraza. Right? Because if you do Alistraza his face, you can fall back
Antoninus,
on another ice block.
The Fireball and Ice Lance? That seems worse than Alistraza. Speak to me.
Let the pain speak to me. Okay. What do you think she's looking for here?
Maybe that if he can't pop the ice block next turn, you Alistraza, put him down to 10, and then you Pyroblast for the win, and then you have Fireball as a backup, perhaps?
Mm-hmm.
This play makes sense in the sense that you're not doing any damage this turn anyways, so if you do develop a board, you can Alistraza next turn and still attack this turn. It actually makes a lot of sense. I'm trying to think if there's any downside of playing this. I guess the downside is you're exposing your Archmage to dying a little bit easier, because this move is not exactly easy to counter by playing Lothab and Healbot. Since if you do play Lothab, or you can't Healbot, but let's say you play Lothab here, then Eloise has an easy Alistraza turn at that point. So it's actually a really good move. No Valid Teacher going down here.
Yeah, and he has to use both Eviscerates too, which means doesn't have damage from the hand outside the weapon.
This Eviscerate play is basically a tell. Oh no, the Assassin's Blade was frozen. Never mind. I thought that. Pay attention, class. I thought that wasn't frozen. So.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. No, that makes all the difference. Yeah. She still has turns left.
Yeah.
I think it's okay just to Alistraza his face now.
Well, you have to ice block or you die, or you Alistraza yourself.
This turn, yeah, it seems like she's gonna play defensive here.
Yeah, you can Alistraza yourself now, actually. Can't you?
There's basically, I feel like there's two options here. One is still save Alistraza for the 15 damage or 13 damage and ice block and play the heal bot this turn. And then also hope that you don't lose the block. That play would mean that you're hoping you don't lose the block, because if you do ice block and heal block and you lose your block anyways, then it just becomes pointless to do that play, I guess, over Alistraza.
She also has ice barriers, right? So if she can draw into those, can further extend her stay in this game.
Yeah. One thing that's also nice too is that both saps have been used, so Alex is like a really relevant threat now.
Especially in a deck with no BGH, an 8/8 is just so hard to kill.
Yeah.
The Blade Flurry has been gone. The Blade Flurry 10 damage weapon. It's hard to Blade Flurry an Assassin's Blade with 3 charges. And it's not even enough.
Yeah, one thing that the play doesn't play around, though, for the Alistraza is that Lothab now shuts down a big majority of the turn. Because you'd want to put Ice Block up next turn with the Heal Bot, but now you have to choose one or the other. You put him down to 16, which means you don't have the guarantee kill either next turn, because you don't have enough burn.
Okay.
Wait, no, you put down the 15.
15 so. With a ping, and if you top deck Frostbolt, that's lethal. Right. But the Healbot is still in Sixo's hand.
Did she actually use both Frostbolt? I think she used one Frostbolt.
Yeah, one Frostbolt, one Ice Lance.
There is a chance there, but with the way Shield's playing, it's more consistent to play a control game and try to survive instead of going for the kill with how Alex Raza has been played. Also, Eloise has not forced out any healing yet, so it's likely that this heal bot is still in Sixo's hand, or maybe an Earthen Ring Farseer. Normally, if you see like the Assassin's Blade, Goblin Barber, it's not going to be Earthen Rings, though. It's going to be a heal bot. It's like a different type of rogue deck. Frostbolt is drawn, but...
Okay. Yeah, again, a very defensive play. She continues to stay in the game, and it does seem like every turn, she's winning more and more right now.
Yeah, and not to mention that she's yet to fish out those ice barriers, which is relevant because Rogues use most of its direct damage burn already. Also, with now...
She's a bit low on cards, though. She's at like 4, I think.
Oh, you mean fatigue-wise?
That's actually relevant. If you go down to fatigue, you can make your blocks useless.
There's a board clear now.
Yeah, she's at 5. She will be on 4 after this turn. Oh, but 6 is on 2!
Wow. Oh! Dude, that's it. Like this plus the heal bot and a couple more cards are all the threats he has left. Yeah. And then now this is a nice
especially barrier. Especially a barrier? Yeah. That's 8 more health. Combined now with a Frost Nova turn.
Antonitis Frost Nova, right? And you just continue to keep it pressed because there's no way Sixo can kill you with direct damage anymore.
Yeah. Six is outside of range of Eviscerate, and this ice barrier means that the weapon isn't going to be too effective.
Oh boy.
It seems like Sixo will fatigue out his whole deck without being able to kill Freeze Mage. Still another Blizzard and Ice Block. I don't know how important Ice Block will be, but...
Yeah, probably just important to set it up in case, but she has yet to hit another Ice Barrier. And if you can just stabilize this board enough, like even if you played board clears, like there's nothing that you can really do.
Yeah. Sixo's actually thinking of playing Heal Block just to go all in. He knows he's all in. I mean, he knows that he can't win a late game by heal botting.
Well, he might think he can because he saw the explosive sheep, so he might be thinking that she may have taken out like a Blizzard for an explosive sheep. I mean, it's unlikely.
Yeah. Or like a flame strike or something like that.
I mean, that's really your only chance.
Yeah, and that should lock it up because she can even just generate like incredible damage right now, back to back. This sets up for a lethal next turn, too. It puts it at 18, which is enough for Antonitis plus 2 fireballs and a pain. So this is another move very confidently that Rogue can't generate 11 damage with one card. And Vile Teacher is not going to be it. So Temple Storm goes up 2-0.
Quite the lead here.
Yep. There it is.
Yeah.
So, Sakko, you said you were excited to watch Eloise play. What's the verdict?
That was a very good game. I think she played really good this game, especially the turns, like the end about like the Alex Straza decision and how to like playing the Archmage on turn 10 instead of Alex Straza. There's like, it's a very, I guess it's a kind of a hard decision to make all the time, and that's like very on point. So it worked out perfectly against Sixo's hand and in this situation, so.
Yeah, it's also like Temple Storm's off to a really good start, but if we've learned one thing, it's not how you start, it's how you finish in this, this conquest, for sure. Best of 11.
Plenty of room for comebacks here.
Yeah, absolutely. With one team racking in the wins, the other team doesn't have to beat as many decks, and it's not as much about the quantity as it is the quality. When it comes to those maybe not so refined, not many good matchup decks. I am curious to see the Priest in all the matches. Gaara and Dog have played with Priest, and by my count, it's like 7 matches so far. Priest has dropped 0 games, and that includes like Freeze Mage and Grim Patron Warrior and everything.
What kind of Priest are they actually playing? I don't know about this.
Okay, well, Dog was playing today as well, was playing the same deck. He was playing the Deathlord anti-aggro Priest with a lot of buffs. Yeah. And Gaara is playing the high combo Wild Pyromancer Light Warden type of thing. I know, lighter than Naru.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Both priests are pretty good. And all, I think both priests are kind of merging together too to become almost one deck. Like you see a lot of hybrids too,
mm-hmm.
you know, using both kinds. It's cool. Excited to see it.
Yeah. Also, I think we'll probably see Firebat here.
Yeah.
I believe the bench rule only works if you lose two in a row. So if Zele comes back and loses one, I don't think he gets benched. If I'm not mistaken.
Yeah,
I think
we'll
you're right.
We'll have to confirm with the admins.
I'm pretty sure you're right about that.
It makes sense.
Yeah,
it is correct.
The point of the bench rule was that we'd see every player, right?
Yeah, there's so, more variety, and there's some strategy for the other
because you can go 0-6 and no one else can ever play.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Well, all right. So I think we're gonna see Firebat though.
Yeah. It is kind of predictable though because normally. You know, if you just lose, you're more demoralized. You don't want to play, and both the other players have lost, and there's only one player that hasn't played. So you might want to play around that and just still kind of do it more random or pick someone else even. But, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if Firebat is playing, but that's more where they can, like, pick a deck that counters Firebat's deck. You know, it's like there's a lot of mind games going in this kind of thing, just like in every Conquest format, even more in this even more in Conquest team format because there's special incentive to trade people since if you're thinking about morale on your team, you know, so you can switch off people. So it's cool.
Is that actually that relevant, the morale of the team?
I don't know. I mean, that is a reason why you would switch person, right? If there's not morale, you could just pick the same guy over and over again.
Outside the bench rule,
too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
All right.
Mage versus Hunter.
Hunter from Gaara. Yeah, that maybe some of that mind games did plan out. I did kind of expect Firebat to play. And
Firebat plays Freeze Mage almost all the time. There's almost no way he's playing any other mage. Freeze Mage against Hunter, I guess it depends whether it's mid-range or face, because most people say that Freeze Mage is favored against face Hunter. Even though that's like a little bit iffy still, but I think it's right.
Okay.
But I would think that it's not good against mid-range Hunter.
Well, Gaara was playing in the last tournament. Sorry to interrupt you, but I do have some insight that Gaara in the last tournament was playing Hunter, and he was playing a fairly strange Hunter, but I think would work very well against Freeze Mage. And it's kind of like a mid-range, but he was running a bunch of the stealth creatures. I think he was actually running Stranglethorn Tiger and like Worgens. Oh. So instead of like the face chargers, you have the stealth creatures.
And then he still has the Lothab and High Main and Trident.
Right. I think so.
Just an Arcane Golem explosive trap.
Okay, maybe not.
That's pretty aggressive.
Yeah, that pretty is aggressive. As aggressive as it gets.
Seems like this is a face hunter.
Did we get confirmation? Oh, yeah, Keeping Owl is an interesting question, too.
It is a very good card, but then again, you need to hit your early drops as well, and without the coin here, you have less to choose from. There's no way you can keep the Arcane Golem Explosive Trap, so if you do keep Owl and you're not like playing it against a Mad Scientist, then you have nothing to play it against. You have no play. You're just stuck hero powering early, which is really bad.
Mm-hmm.
Did Mulligan the Owl.
Yeah, if you mulligan the owl, it just tells you you have two of them, right? You want more aggression at the start, you have two owls, so you don't care.
Both barriers are drawn, which is...
It's really good for the mage.
Yeah.
I think it's really good, yeah. I mean, you'd rather get it from Mad Scientist, but I mean, it's still healing against Face Hunter. Can't really go wrong with it. I would expect a three-drop being coined out here. Oh, wow. Doomsayer just to buy tempo. Doomsayer. It makes a lot of sense just to use Doomsayer like that in this matchup, but it is against a Haunted Creeper, so.
Right. It actually increases the power on board, but it's the descent, you know, to create an opportunity for the Acolyte to get dropped.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it does
this
help.
This move was really good against what Gaara just drew. The Animal Companion was a really good card, but now you can't play it.
Yeah.
It still has the bow, though, and that allows him to push for if he needs to.
I'm kind of expecting just the hero power here, honestly, over a bow, just because you know, you're never going to get that hero power back, whereas you can get the bow damage back later. And this matchup is so uninteractive in a way that I feel like there's not really a reason to play your Eaglehorn bow to spend the 3 mana on it this turn. You know, it's not like you're really needed bow stuff. I guess it makes sense because the Acolyte of Pain That way you could kill Acolyte of Pain next turn while still playing minions.
Okay. His curve next turn is looking pretty awkward though with a bunch of threes. I know that 6-0, for example, and Firebat were telling... I think it was 6-0. I was talking about like how as if you play against Hunter, you need to even go as far as to keep Ice Barrier in your hand because of how important it is to stabilize the early game damage. So that way you have mid-game options. Sometimes your mid-game options in Freeze Mage are completely limited because you just have such low health that it almost is insignificant. It's like, well, sure, you freeze the board, but I'm threatening to kill you.
So with this play, Firebat is looking to ping, Acolyte ping on turn 5 because if the Acolyte is dropped here, it will die only drawing one card to the Eaglehorn Bow. It's the more... This move is more greedy. You can get two cards from Acolyte this way, but it's, I guess, less tempo. Draw less.
Misha seems like the worst one here. You just kind of, like, with this matchup, you want damage and you want it this turn, I believe.
Like, that's the mindset. Should it be the worst here? Like, they all will eventually die to AoE. Huffer gets the 4 damage. Liel gets 2 damage immediately, and it's just as hard to kill as Misha. I think Misha is definitely the worst here. Firebat is thinking about fireballing the Misha or playing another move.
Yeah, he goes with Fireball.
I mean, oftentimes in this matchup, you can win with, like, the Alex draws a beatdown. It's kind of weird. Like, Facehugger fizzles out so quickly and, like, run out of cards. You can even, like Hero Power Mage, like, Hero Power down the board, like, things like Wolf Rider. So, like, any minion can win you the game. You don't really need to save Fireballs for Face, but it's definitely an option as well.
I like Gaara's option to save the bow. It makes it so it's more resilient against an Acolyte play.
Yeah, it just gives him more options in general, too. The only thing that it's weak against is if he draws a second weapon that he needs to immediately do damage with. Like, if he had a Glaivezooka or something and he wants to be able to get out over turns. But he did see one Ice Barrier, so it's unlikely his opponent might have a second Ice Barrier, especially in the hand. It might be through Mad Scientist.
Mm-hmm. I think I'd prefer to see a Leprechaun over a Worgen in addition to the Wolf Rider because he already has a lot of one health minions on board, so the Leprechaun by itself is not going to often get damage into face, while the Worgen will later on.
Yeah, that makes sense. Like, against AoE, everything dies anyways, and this is not a turn where ping matters just because there's so many other minions to ping. A Blizzard here. I'm not sure if it will go down and be surprised. I think the options here is either Blizzard or Ice Barrier and Acolyte, especially after the Eaglehorn Bows has been used. There's not an easy way to do 3 damage to Acolyte now. That's like a reason why you would maybe hold a bow. Oh, it doesn't play Acolyte.
Okay.
Yeah, I think he's just valuing the damage. Like, a ping is basically gain 2 health, Acolyte. Second Arcane Golem. Oh my goodness.
That's kind of bad, because you have to play stuff here, don't you?
Very soon it won't matter. Once Freeze Mage gets, you know, at 10 mana, it doesn't matter. It's very likely that on turn 8 it doesn't matter either, because Alex Draz is already on 9. So I guess it does matter this turn. You're rushing them into faster Alex Draza, but it's hard to play nothing again, huh? So...
Yeah. Well, certainly you want to at least
play, well, just be one.
Yeah, that's true. You certainly at least want to play the Worgen Infiltrator.
Yeah.
Oh, what? Misplay. Cone of Cold. Time to get wrecked.
Well, Cone of Cold means he loses everything, versus if he played it in the middle, he'd lose almost everything except for one damage.
Yeah. It matters, but Cone of Cold probably not being played.
Yeah.
It's very rare to see Cone of Cold now.
Can he even kill his opponent, like, threaten to kill, though, if he plays Arcane Golem this turn? He's at 13, and if the board gets wiped, he only has 4-9 damage, so... Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's the block. The,
Mad Scientist is such a good draw mana
here. Ice block there. If he really needs it.
Yeah, because without this Mad Scientist here, you still have no way to develop your ice blocker or barrier, so Dunleash is probably going to be saved for with the Kill Command.
Is that enough?
It's not enough.
He has because 10 no next matter. Turn. Well, 10 is next
turn.
Oh,
next turn, you mean?
Yeah. If Fireback plays a creature, Gaara has 11. And if he doesn't Frostbolt his own Mad Scientist, he will die.
The weird thing is, if you play Arcane Golem, it gives Fireback a way to suicide the Mad Scientist to get the Ice
right.
Block.
So you don't
but
do
if
that.
You don't play it, you don't have mana to play it next turn either. If you want
yeah, you do. Them. It's 9 mana.
Oh, I guess you don't have no mana hero power then.
You don't need to hero power. It's 11 damage if Fireback plays one creature.
That's actually really interesting to just not play the Arcane Golem so that the Mad Scientist can't suicide.
I think he'd rather him have the Ice Block anyways and just be threatening to kill. But then the dangerous part is if he has Alex Strauser, right? And he gets the Ice Block now. Mm-hmm. No, well, that's actually convenient for the second time you can live here.
You can Frostbolt face, coin Frostbolt face if you want. But yeah. I think it's probably better to just ping Frostbolt face, coin ping.
Might be better to coin ping instead of coin Frostbolt.
Yeah, so you can freeze him again on a future turn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And also you can, if you have infinite fireballs, you can only cast 12 or 13 damage a turn, whereas if you keep the Frostbolt in your hand, you can deal 15. Because even if you have infinite fireballs, you can't spend that last 2 mana.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Can he actually outrace him, though? I mean, this is 17.
With 2 ice blocks, very damage. Likely.
Yeah, that's true. Unless he can unless he prioritizes killing Antonitis.
Yeah. It seems like there's no way you can win the game if you're going to kill Antonitis, because you also need to get the blocks. Yeah, Gaara,
yeah, so that's second ice block
this
move.
This
is really big.
Obvious to him. He had to just go for the blocks. I agree. I mean, there's no way you've been killing Antonitis here. This forces either Alexstrasza answer or second ice block or a heal bot. Fireback has the worst of all those options. Like, the second ice block is the worst one of those options. But it seems like it'll probably still be enough to win the race.
Well, it's good enough no matter what. Like, the hunter would have to gain life, and he's not doing that. So, because here you attack Fireball and Frostbolt, right? And then next turn you have 13.
Yeah, it had to be a flare. It had to be a flare from Gaara, which I don't know.
Kazan.
Kazan missed.
Archmage is still a body, too.
That's true. So even if you heal, it might not even be significant.
Yeah, this is putting at 12, so 2 Fireballs. There's no way, unless you have something really weird. Lothab, maybe. No. Would Lothab have done it?
Yeah, Lothab would have done it.
But there's one like life. This deck is not running Lothab with face center. So.
Right.
Well, that's what we thought when Chalky was throwing like weird stuff to Snake Traps and a Lothab.
Oh,
look at that.
Alexstrasza. Easy game, boys.
BM with Alexstrasza.
He's trolling. Wow. Could be.
Oh, you know what? He's pointing Alexstrasza at himself just to show Gaara that he had it. And he's just going to kill with fireballs.
But he could just point a fireball at his face to fake it, too.
That's true. But anything to just kind of throw him off. This is Firebat trying to get inside the head of him.
It's obvious that he's trolling because there's no way that he doesn't. Oh, my God.
Wait. Quick shot into.
Is it possible?
Quick shot, kill command. Quick shot.
I don't know. I wanted to lose, though, after that. Another quick shot, maybe, into something.
Oh, man. I thought I was just missing something. I'm like, is there a trap up that we don't see or something?
No. He would need quick shot into. Like, he needed 4 more damage after...
If that last card was not a Knife Juggler, it was a cheaper card, it...
Oh, no! Quick Shot Leroy!
Quick Shot Leroy, exactly.
Yeah.
Knife Juggler made it impossible because it cost 2 mana.
Oh, right. Mm.
Like, say it was an Abusive Sergeant, you could go Abusive, Quick Shot, and Quick Shot into Leroy, Hero Power, and then Bow would be 15. Oh, man.
Wonder if this attitude permeates without...
Not worth it, I think.
I wonder if this attitude permeates throughout Archon, because, maybe Firebat's trying to, like, throw one to Zalae and be like, look, man, I missed lethal too. It's okay. We can still win. We got this.
Yeah, maybe.
Well, definitely Firebrand having a little bit of fun while he can squeeze it in. And maybe that rattles Gaara a little bit. That'd be pretty fun. That means Archon gets their first win on the board. And that's also, you know, able to identify what type of hunter Gaara is, see a lot of their cards so you can get a good sense of it. So that's pretty useful information here for Archon as well.
Mm-hmm. And we also see, man, Freeze Mage cleaning up. Three wins so far, two of them taken by Freeze Mages.
Yeah, the Freeze Mage in general is just really powerful for Conquest against the lineup, especially aggressive decks. It specializes in stopping the aggro. I mean, there's a lot of things that we can look at for what Freeze Mage was good against Hunter, face Hunter specifically. The two ice barriers that helped a lot. Being able to get into the ice blocks without no ability to, you know, pressure before to pop it or kill. Mm-hmm. And then it was able to race just fine if you get Antonice or Alexstrasza on the board, so it's okay.
Yeah. All right. You think it's going to be Zele here? It's going to be like prepped up, as Strifecro mentioned.
Yeah. He's had some time to, you know, clear his head, take some walks. I know Firebat and Zele both like hiking a lot, so maybe they sent Zele walking a little bit, packing.
Actually, from what I remember, in the opening few games, Team Archon did okay, but Zele kind of was on the end of the lineup, and he couldn't quite pull out the wins.
Yeah, that was the disagreement again within the team that you know, they were saying that they don't think Zele played to the best of his potential, that he was struggling a little bit playing Patron a little poorly compared to what he normally does. And maybe it changes this week, but it's only the results will speak for themselves. Zele could lose one game and then ends up winning the next two games pretty easy peasy, or he can do the same exact thing and lose four or five games.
Yeah. And the Patron turn.
Patron boys.
Well, if it comes 5-6 and they end up losing by one game, they realize they had that one game won.
Yeah.
That's heart crushing.
Well, it changes everything. I mean, it's hard to even say because when you take out a deck in Conquest, it, you know, it changes all the time. It's hard to even say, like, it, you know, just that one game. It's not just
true,
that.
True.
So Tempestorm throws Gaara out again. If Gaara loses, he will be benched. But I'd argue that, like, his deck doesn't have that many counters left. Like, Hunter is just generally good against stuff, and Priest is just generally good against stuff.
Against Hunter, face Hunter is usually ahead of any other Hunter, whatever it is.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, but 6-1 knows, like, a lot of what Gaara's deck is, so they probably would go in more deliberately with this match. And I think they were hoping to catch maybe the Warlock or the Rogue. 6-0 again, coming in here with the Hunter. Do you ever keep Explosive Trap at all in the mirrors, or do you feel like you value the curve too much?
I think so, especially with the Mad Scientist. I would say it's very, very hard to make a decision to ever keep a trap. I think the only trap I've ever kept was Snake Trap against, like, Zoo or something, if you have a good hand for it. But yeah, it was Mulligan. I wonder if, I mean, 6-0 plays a lot of Face Hunter as well, so it could just be Face Hunter Mirror, which means no one really has an edge. It really depends how their decks are teched out, or I guess the draws. But
yeah, I was just thinking because I remember talking to Colento a couple months back, and he was saying that if he has Mad Scientist and Explosive Trap, and he knows he needs to be like, he needs Explosive Trap to either stay like aggressive on the board or whatnot, he'd actually throw Mad Scientist back and keep Explosive against Hunters. And so that when I heard that, I was like, whoa, that blew my mind. And then
it might be a different version, like late game with tracking or something. There's no way you'll know your fault. There's no way you mulligan Mad Scientist in the opening hand.
Well, he says that it's because it's more effective. Like, people can play around the Explosive Trap if they see the Mad Scientist versus the Explosive Trap just straight up is like two damage.
Now, what do you guys think about this attack as the game's going on here? 6-0 picks up a Knife Juggler to follow his two Haunted Creepers against the Leper Gnome. It feels like going face with the Worgen is not necessarily a win-win because you get such an easy kill on the Leper Gnome, probably some juggles next turn. I
wonder.
That's like, you might get two hits in off the Worgen if you don't attack the first turn.
I would expect almost face with the Mad Scientist, with the Mad Scientist dropped, because In this matchup, like, the person making more trades is usually going to be losing. Both hunters have ways to clear the board, such as Unleash the Hounds and Explosive Trap. So if you're constantly trading, they're going to face. And even if you make slightly better trades, they're still going to be able to just bounce right back with Explosive and or Unleash the Hounds. And I feel like, especially if you're going to play the Mad Scientist, getting your trap, he should have just gone face, probably.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, look at that. The Eaglehorn bow ends up coming to the hand, which means an additional charge will be given to the bow where you can swing again because of that explosive trap coming out.
Yeah. 6-0 does decide not to attack. Or Gar decides not to attack. Through the trap. The Knife Struggler is threatening some damage every turn. And attacking gives another charge, so this way it's hard to play any minions here. You know that every minion you play gets traded off for free because of the explosive killing everything anyways. So it allows the other player to cash in the minions on whatever you play before attacking.
Yeah, but what about the owl on the haunted creeper? That kind of removes both the 1/1s.
Cool one, yeah. Because that actually
does something.
Yeah, it does something, exactly. I wouldn't mind that play. I think it's pretty good. It depends, like, if you would have something like Unleash the Hounds here or another explosive. If you did have Unleash the Hounds or another explosive, you might not want to do it and just save the owl for their Mad Scientist, you know, because you can deal with the other creepers anyways. But yeah, this is good because he doesn't have any of those cards. I don't think there's any way you're attacking with the bow here.
Well, apparently there's some way because Gar is channeling his brain power to making that decision.
Right before the explosive trap.
It's like that scene in The Simpsons. Remember where Mr. Burns asked Smithers to massage his brain? Did you ever watch that? All right. Maybe no. It's just me.
Yes, I've seen all The Simpsons. All
right.
At least like pre-season 10 or something.
Well, he was
being terrible.
He was going really ham on the temples there. Gar is thinking really hard about some of
this is interesting. Just like a huge stall. But the problem with the huge stall is whoever makes the stalling move, like whoever's playing a lot of minions, is weak to Unleash. I guess that's why 6-0 played the explosive trap as well, because this way if you get Knife Juggler Unleashed, you still can't take damage from that combo. Even if the Knife Juggler Unleashed kills all your minions with pings, once you know the explosive trap still clears everything, it's really smart actually to play explosive if you're going to make this like stall move to stop Unleash the Hounds.
Mm. Yeah, that's a really good point. And then Gar from here is also still continued to scare to build the board because of that Knife Juggler just sitting there. He doesn't have a direct answer.
Yeah, I don't think the Knife Juggler is really the issue. It's just nice to save up the creatures, really. Alright.
Yeah, but now Explosive Trap again gets less value. It's not even about value though, the damage is just sitting there impending.
Yeah. It's really interesting. I really like how 6-0 did this. How Gar did this by not attacking, because like his hand, it seemed like it was better. Like Gar had to break the stalemate himself by attacking with the bow. Because his hand was more minion-based, like Animal Companion and Haunted Creeper. So if you just Hero Power, just trade Hero Powers for 10 turns and the other person has a faster hand, like more, you know, more burn, like Arcane Golems and stuff, you'll lose. So it really, you know, he forced the other person to break the stalemate. That's like a +3 health swing because -1 charge of the bow, so.
Well, does he try to stop the damage here and cash in before the explosive trap and then go charge, or would he? Okay, he's trading down.
Yeah. Trading off as much as he can before playing.
Mm-hmm. Okay, oh, reasonable.
There is an Unleash the Hound, so it's not mandatory to clear the 1/1.
Yeah, but Gara has the slight damage lead right now, and he's got a weapon.
This game is going to come down to, like, I think breakpoints, you know, like both people probably have enough damage to kill their player. It's almost about if you get someone down to 1, then they can overkill you or kill you exactly. You know, it's going to be pretty complicated as far as that.
It seems though that Gar is a bit in the lead. He just has more options, especially if Animal Companion goes his way.
What do you want?
Even the Misha would be good as a taunt here. No owl. Again, you want to squeeze out as many hero powers as you can as well, but it might not be possible on some of these turns.
What do you think about just like controlling the board another turn because you have a good hand?
Like, I think you're scared of explosive trap number two if you play your two drops here. Well, that's actually a complete pass. Oh, okay. This makes sense to play just Mad Scientist because it's a slow card, Mad Scientist. By playing it now, you can develop your explosive trap before the game ends to save yourself some life. Whereas if you played it after the Animal Companion, you know, the game would likely be over before your Mad Scientist dies. Also get to save Animal Companion for Kill Command. But Knife Jugger wasn't played just because this explosive trap on Mad Scientist, meaning it's probably going to be useless.
Yeah, not to mention that he can curve it out next turn with the Animal Companion and Hero Power, so he gets that extra damage in case it ends up popping here. So I think it's also...
To see this, yeah, just to unleash getting more damage. I would expect the Mad Scientist to trade for other Mad Scientists, but face on everything else.
I think we're just going to see face all the way.
No, because of you need to play defense, so you're going to die next turn. Oh, wow, no trap coming down. That's weird. Wonder why I traded for the one if he's going to get the explosive anyways, or if he is.
He has the weapon to activate the trap and get past it.
I think I'm really behind because I just saw the trade now.
Okay. I don't know. I kind of just predicted a trade. It wasn't like I didn't see it then. Oh, okay. I can't imagine not trading there because if you don't get your explosive trap out here, there's no point in making the move you made two turns ago to play the Mad Scientist and... is it likely you die too without the explosive trap? It just seems like waste one damage.
Garo will want to try to set his opponent to 2-0. Oh, it's Snake Trap.
Oh, that's that why sucks. It was not.
That sucks.
If this is Huffer. Oh. Not Huffer. Wait, does that mean it's game then?
Hold on. I think 6-0 wins, doesn't he?
What does he have in his, is it Eagle Horn Bow? It's a Snake Trap.
I mean, for Gara.
Or actually, it could be a Freezing Trap.
Actually, why did he play Misha? Misha gives him...
No, Misha was for lethal.
Oh, he tried to get it.
If he was trying
I think 6-0 might actually be playing Freezing Trap, so even if it was Huffer, that's not guaranteed lethal.
This is so hard for me, Cass. I'm just so confused because two punchers. I don't know who's who at this point at all. I have been confused.
Well, that is definitely lethal.
Yes, so you can use... Wait, is it?
Yeah,
it is.
It was lethal before that, I feel. Because the leopard no damage. Yeah, because you get him to 8, then you get him to the 6 with your bow.
Oh, right. Leopard gnome damage.
Yeah. He 6-0 didn't have to draw that.
Whoa, that was so close.
More damage.
You know what? More importantly, guess who's on the bench?
Oh, man.
Gara is riding the bench.
Gara boys. Never lucky. Never lucky.
I think his voice would go up a couple of pitches while saying that for sure. Well, that means only Rogue and Warlock are available for Tempo Storm, and Gara is now officially benched. So, with that in mind,
twice as many options.
Yeah.
Got benched.
Rogue and Warlock.
Hmm.
Is that a time to bust out the Warrior here?
I think you want to play a deck that is weak to Gara's deck so you can dodge that matchup. So whatever is weak to Hunter and Priest, like, because you know that Gara can't play. I wonder what that would be.
Maybe though. Rogue. Oh no, but Rogue's good against Priest, but it's bad against Hunter.
Yeah. There's nothing too great.
Yeah.
Maybe the Warlock, like actually. The Warlock can be capitalized. If he's playing a Zoo deck, can be abused by both Hunter and Priest, maybe.
Oh, I yeah. Just, if this is Handlock, you want to keep it against Priest, right? But if it's Zoo, definitely want to dodge Hunter and Priest, because Zoo is probably disfavored against both Hunter and Priest.
Like, a lot of the Handlock lists we've seen recently don't have Jiraxxus and have Ragnaros. I think that alone just screws up that matchup pretty hard.
It does, but I still think it's probably pretty Handlock favored. Tribrigans are hard to deal with.
It is, but I think Gardas Priest is running at least one Light Bomb, maybe two. Uh-huh. It's kind of hard to like push for like actual damage with Handlock, and it's hard to actually like win if you just lose all your creatures.
Yeah. I've definitely played Handlock games where they've killed every single minion, but you still win with Jiraxxus. But yeah, without Jiraxxus, it could be that you can't win as the Handlock if they have all the answers. It does rely a lot on the hero power, though, because if you play Mountain Giants to get death, you have Life Tap to keep playing more stuff. So who knows? Well, it's definitely dependent.
I'm guessing Druid. I'm going for Druid here.
Okay. I feel like it will be Warlock if it's Zoo, but...
Oh, Warlock versus Warlock.
If it's
Warlock.
Firebat, it's more likely to be Zoo, I think. You usually play Zoo. I'm not sure. I mean, Firebat could definitely play Unlock as well.
Alright. I didn't quite see these artist impressions of the players here. I didn't realize Luis was a rabbit.
I'm
pretty sure that's a cat.
Oh, it's a cat.
Yeah. Rabbit ears are actually much, much, much longer.
Okay. Yeah. I'm AFK. Please don't sap me.
There you go. So Strife Crow.
Yeah.
Looking like it's just gonna be me and you for now. Yeah. Oh, we see a Mortal Coil and a Sludge Belcher, so that's one person's Handlock.
Mm-hmm.
That's Eloise. Yeah, I think Sunfire Protector.
I feel like it's not obvious enough whose turn it is.
Oh, you mean in terms of like whose hand is whose?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whose
turn it is in general. Oh, blue highlight. Okay. I wish I was told of this earlier, but I'm going to look for the blue
highlight. Oh, we could have totally trolled him by saying the gray highlight.
Yeah. The Hunter vs. Hunter game confused me a lot because I didn't know who was Gar and who was 6-0. Even though I knew like some of the turns, not all the turns. It's too confusing. Yeah. Like the exact same deck fighting against each other.
Yeah. In the past, it used to be noticeable too. Like one person would be like a golden hero, and then another person probably wouldn't be. But now that the game's been out long enough that everyone practically has golden heroes of everything.
Yeah.
Okay. Can't,
so Firebat was Zoo. I think I could really predict that pick then, because once Gar is benched, you want to get your Zoo the win before Hunter and Priest come back. So this is. This is Firebat's chance to dodge the bad Zoo matchups.
Mm-hmm.
I think Tempo Storm predicted it, though, and played Handlock against Zoo. I mean, it was definitely correct for both sides to do this. Because Handlock is usually a slight favorite against Zoo.
Yeah, although Monk told me an interesting statistic that Zoos have like an overwhelming win percentage against Handlocks in tournaments since Blackrock came out.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, like 67% plus type of statistic, and they've played like 15 or 16 games. Now, I mean, it's a small sample.
Has more death rattle minions now that are stronger, like Void Caller. So the AoE is not as effective, because if you AoE and like a Mal'Ganis comes out or a Dimguard, you don't really clear the board. So,
yep.
Hey guys, back from the sap. Yep. Just guys know every time Void Terror comes down, Power Bombing in hand, I feel really sad.
the wasted potential.
Yeah.
What could have been?
No, nice top deck.
Wow. Yeah. Still really, really good stuff from the Zoo player. Power Bomb, Doomguard coming off the
good mana curve.
Void Caller. Well, it's probably not. It's probably going to get silenced here.
Mm-hmm. That Owl. But first, you probably want to draw with the Mortal Coil.
You can draw with both Mortal Coils, actually.
Yeah. True.
Probably the Void Terror is going to be taken out with an attack and Mortal Coil, and then Mortal Coil the other one, followed by the Owl on Void Caller. You could completely yellow it and just kill the Void Caller. There's only 4 cards in Warlock's hand. We know that it won't work out, but...
It will really not work out.
It's not an impossible move to make because of the only 4 cards.
Yeah. I always hate to do that. Like, I don't know. I hate to do this in arena and construct it. I'd be crazy too.
It seems like that's not happening. The complete
Alistraza. Look at that.
Interesting.
Everyone's been dropping Draxus lately,
Wait. Oh, this makes more sense than what I said, I think, because this way you don't kill the Void Terror, but you only there's only one minion on board for Defender of Argus this way.
That does make sense.
Okay. Because the other way you leave a 3-4 and a 1-1, this way you live up a 4-5, so it's better against Defender of Argus. It's really, yeah, I think it's a good move.
Okay.
Is this a potential lethal push for the next couple turns, though? He's got a lot of damage up against this, but now how do you deal with this Void Caller efficiently at all? It feels really difficult.
Yeah. Void Caller number two. Don't. It's probably going to be, just don't.
Belcher time, probably.
Problem is, Eloise does not have a BGH, so the Sea Giant Dr. Boom combo could be scary. This Belcher is going to do so much work, though. It feels so bad to be on the side of the board as Zoo when you're, like, you still have to play around Molten Giants and all the AoE and Taunters, and you're not even ahead on board after this. Mm-hmm. It's so weird to be in this position here.
Well, you have Dr. Boom next turn, so you just kind of have to play out a really good turn here. I would expect a
Life Tap here, and followed by a Power Whelming and Doomguard and Flame Imp. If problem is, if you life tap into like
Imp Game
a
boss.
Certain demon, maybe you don't guarantee it.
Yeah. Two Power Overwhelmings.
All right, well, you called it. Seems like the only play that accomplishes anything and tries to get ahead on the board, which is really all you do.
Unfortunately, your Doomguard doesn't have charge here. So.
Yeah, and it also gets cleared by Hellfire now, or even Dark Bomb. Like, those type of things are easy to stay.
Double Giant. While Double Giant is so good, especially if you can get to Double Giant without getting bursted, and it feels like she is not going to be able to get bursted here. I have
no time. Go for Sylvanas.
Okay. She still feels like she's not under much threat. One Power Overwhelming has been used.
This game is rid of Ultel. Anytime Hellfire plus Double Molten comes down with the Sun Fury, the game is probably going to be over.
I think it's going to happen.
So Farbat really needs to go for like a one turn kill or something.
I mean,
doesn't look like it's happening.
Though. Yeah, when you're losing as an aggressive player, you kind of like, well, if they have like the perfect answer, then I just won't be bothered to play around it.
Exactly. Especially the Boom Bots may do some extra face damage as well. Dark Bomb gives more chance as well because you can always Dark Bomb your own face. As weird as that sounds, sometimes it's the right move.
Dark Bomb your own face.
It seems like the Hellfire would go first.
There's like the guy that Soulfired his own face back when Soulfire was zero mana. And then Molten Sun Fury.
Yeah, that was more of a good play back then because Soulfire cost zero. It was mostly about gaining a mana tempo.
Yeah.
With Dark Bomb, it's much less likely, but I can see how sometimes it could be the best play.
Is there a good way to do this in sequence, Sarko?
The sequencing here, I believe, would just be Hellfire first and see what happens.
No, you can Dark Bomb the Doomguard. So if Sylvanas does die, you automatically steal Dr. Boom. But you kind of give up.
I almost feel it doesn't even matter too much what it steals, whether it's Dr. Boom or Doomguard.
Yeah.
As long as you get yourself in range where you can play
Molten's next turn.
Molten's and Sun Fury's. I would even say this turn would be better. The Boom Bots ran kind of bad on that.
Yeah, actually,
even the Dark Bomb gives you a little more options sometimes.
If the Boom Bots hit both for one face, Lewis would have had nothing.
Yeah. But now she gets like a lot of options.
That's so funny. That's like, you know, the worst possible boom bots that generally occur for a Zoo deck were like the best ones possible for Firebat. Shields up.
Well, this is really troublesome for the Zoo player. very
this is like a personality test here, because you can get the free tap. Like, it's actually interesting to see. I from my perspective, there's no difference here. You win the game no matter what you do. But I feel like players like me, I'm sure like Trump, like 100% tap here. It's just because it's not in our personality. It's too greedy, you know? It's like, but Luis is very conservative, it seems, and not going for the tap here.
Life coach makes that tap.
Either way, a life coach makes this tap, I feel. It's just nice to see. Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Well, because you know, one thing I was told in the past is that a mark of a great handlock player is being able to tap at all times and knowing when you can camp.
Yeah, yeah. It would actually physically pain me not to tap here. Like, it would make me hurt. Even though either way is like a pretty much a 100% win, I think. Like, there's no difference, but...
Oh, wow. Look at that. Victory dance.
Yeah. That's how they do it, man.
Well, that's all right. That's a 2-0 for Eloise, which means she's done for the day. Yep. And now Gaara's unbenched.
Yeah, good thing, too, because otherwise Hype would have to play Rogue, which would suck.
Also, interesting to note that Eloise brought rather like aggressive-ish decks last time. She brought like a very fast Druid with Zoo, and then this week she brought Handlock and Freeze Mage, so she mixed it up. So that's, quite a bit. That's another thing, too, where it was a cool different change of styles.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. Well, they're up the point here. We just have to keep in mind, like, you know, all these decks have to win. So right now, I feel like generally people don't have confidence in Priest, but I have confidence in Priest. I just feel Gaara might be in the never lucky moment right now. You know.
One thing that I can share is that Gaara has been really trying to ramp up his like performance and results, because the window's closing for points, World Championship, and it's not even about that this league awards points, but it's like it's got people into the mindsets like, okay, the competitive season is here, it's a lot of money, I need to really start proving myself, and this is probably one of the most high profile tournaments you'll play in for the summer. So this is like, you know, if there's any person that's like super try hard, we joke about Forsen, we joke about a few other guys that might be more lax, but Gaara is like one of the most try hard players out there in terms of like wanting it the most and trying really to his best of his ability.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, he's been doing pretty well recently, even though in the case where he does do very well, his play is criticized a little bit. I am a pretty big Gaara fan, but I don't know. I'm just like a Gaara fan overall. I just like to see him play. I think sometimes, even if he screws up, it's actually more entertaining. So, yep.
Yeah, I think so too, for better or for worse. So now that Gaara's unbenched, I'm looking here at the matchups. We have Rogue, Priest, and Hunter up against Rogue, Druid, Warlock, and Warrior. Now that the field is narrowing down a little bit, Strifeco, are there like picks that you start gravitating towards, or are you still feeling like this is a little bit more of the random, like just choose whatever you feel like is good, don't get benched type of scenario?
I don't even feel like it's even a don't get benched scenario. I don't think it matters even get benched technically. So I don't know. I mean, there's never a situation where I would feel any different other than just picking a random deck, I guess. Unless you want to mind game people. Like, I don't think mathematically it ever changes. As far as I know, even with the bench rule.
I was about to say,
someone's already benched.
It was actually Gaara who knocked out Zele out of the tournament.
The HTC event.
Yeah, I think so. With the Priest taking a win over the Grim Patron Warrior.
Oh, wow, that's a hard matchup.
Yeah.
Pretty much need, Harrison Jones, maybe. Some light bombs. I wouldn't be surprised if it was still a pretty bad matchup, even with all the AoE, though, just because it's hard to pressure as a priest, and then you just get one shot after Emperor with like the double frothings charging at you for like 40 each or something.
Well, we have a face hunter 40. With a secret already up here.
I think that's just an overlay mistake.
Yeah, of course. Okay. Rogue, though, this is a nice hand. To kind of defend the early game. It's really like, if you get a slow hand or like too many spells, you have to waste them so badly and you just kind of deteriorate if you don't. And you kind of deteriorate if you do, if your answers aren't good enough. But this is a kind of rogue hand that the answers for typical early game are good enough.
Yeah, the Violet Teacher, generally speaking, is one of the key cards to help dissect the Hunter board or traps. But sometimes you don't even have enough. Like this Hopper, for example, that's just so much damage and pressure right back.
Mm-hmm. Oh, heal block.
Heal block, though. I don't know. I'm kind of feeling it for the Rogue in this game. The opening hand is just like exceptional, honestly. Mm-hmm.
There's also another way to proc SI with the Deadly Poison next turn. The 1-1s can get Freezing Trap if that's a thing. You don't want to play too many 1-1s here. Unleash the Hounds can be scary, but at this point, if you play them early, you can just cash in your 1-1s, you know, like trade them as the game goes. You won't ever have a huge board.
Okay, that's a good point.
Well, you kind of want to play that Eviscerate, but I don't know.
Probably going to be Deadly Poison Eviscerate, but I feel like that's a little bit overcommitting on 1-1s as far as Unleash the Hounds goes.
Right.
I don't see another great option.
It's coming down to the Knife Juggler Unleash the Hounds turn, too.
It really has to be the play Striker suggested here. Nothing else really accomplishes too much.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
That's brave.
That is really brave. Expect the face tank on Misha.
But he does
Play around control. Unleash a little bit, yeah.
That's more damage though.
You just took 4 extra damage though. Which is probably more than the 1 extra minion would have done anyways from Unleash.
Every turn is like 5 damage at least for the next couple turns.
Mm-hmm.
Can you stabilize in time? That healbot is really clutch, though. My goodness.
Yeah, with the healbot, I think the Rogue has this game. Yeah.
There's no way that you trade for the 1-1 because you have second Unleash of Hounds as well.
It's just like, I feel like the Face Hunter kind of plays a very similar game in almost every game. Like, the turn clock is fairly consistent. It's just the Rogue that has the wild variation. And I think this matchup isn't too one-sided. So it must mean, with a hand like that, the Rogue has to do pretty well. Like, it's just, I don't know.
Just I mean, there's a good early game, but then, again, Gaara has a really good hand, as well as there's no Tinker Oils and Preps. You know, usually you want to start closing out the game at this point with Prep Oil Flurry. But, like, even though there's early board development, there's not a great end game follow-up, I guess. But there is Healbot and Eviscerate. The way that Sixth played was super aggressive because he effectively gets to save his Eviscerate for the final burst, as well as developing a stronger minion in the 3-3.
Whoa!
Wow.
Yeah, that's really good. Now you can use Knife Juggler and Unleash the Hounds.
Yeah, but this is a little bit weird, right? You die here as Gaara unless you start clearing the board, probably. I mean, he has to feel like he probably dies, leaving up 10 power with 16 life, and we do know that he actually does die because of the Eviscerate for 5, Hero Power for 1.
Oh, yeah, the Eviscerate has a spell damage.
Yeah, with the sap to proc the combo.
Well, the Knife Juggler might just solve his problem for him.
Mm-hmm. Knife Juggler and Leech, hopefully just to kill some minion.
I wonder if he's thinking about setting up 2-turn kill too in the process, like how you go about.
Sure.
Because next turn he's got Wolf Rider.
Wolf Rider here to remove the 3-3. Maybe even double Wolf Rider here, 1-3-3 to face. Actually, it sounds like it sets up better because then you can Knife Juggler and Leech and Quick Shot.
Well, I was thinking Wolf Rider, save a Wolf Rider for a Quick Shot and the Hero Power next turn for 8 damage.
I think Unleash is more Knife Juggler move.
Okay. Interesting.
I don't know. I'm not sure.
What do you think about saving that Wolf Rider there and Hero Powering instead?
I like playing the Wolf Rider more. You get in one more damage, and it seems like next turn is going to be game over for either player. Like, there's not going to be a turn 8 for US Hunter here, I think, right? Next turn, it's going to be the last turn.
So how much damage is his maximum for Hunter?
Well, he basically has to clear. Wow.
Oh, well, that helps clear a lot.
Yes, it does.
So he's got 10 damage this turn maximum from the hand, I think. So then I guess he has to clear instead.
Mm-hmm.
Is it max 10?
Yeah, even if all the
Unleashes,
it's only 11, I think. if you count the Abyss of Pink Face 2, which is, I think you just have to see what happens before, like,
yeah, that's exactly.
Start by Juggle Unleash and then you know, see how the pings go.
Put this apple on your head. All right, well, let's see what happens. He wants it on the minions themselves, right?
He wants it like on the Azure Drake, I think.
Especially the Drake, because it has the spell power and the most damage.
It's pretty good, though.
Yeah, okay. Get in there and fight,
maggot. Looks like he's going to leave it on a teacher with how it is. I don't know if he's going to die because of that, but it's hard. Yeah, there's no way you can clear it anyway, so.
Yeah, if a prep comes into the rogue hand, it's over.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, prep is easy lethal. With oil and eviscerate. Flotheb. Is that lethal? No. Because there's no weapon to play oil and eviscerate.
Yeah, he's one damage off.
Yeah.
One mana, one damage.
Yeah.
Wow, if there's a weapon up last turn, he would have won this turn, huh?
Yeah, but he couldn't do that plus Yulba.
Yeah. And unfortunately, for 6-0, it's hard for him to play defensive because he doesn't have AoE either.
Yeah, but with Lotheb down, and assuming there's only how much damage can your opponent realistically generate?
Yeah, Lotheb trade for charges. The juggler.
Yeah.
Or is he sapping the juggler going face?
Okay. I'm ready to learn. So Quill like already had in his mind that he'd be taking damage.
He might just trade anyways. Yeah. Because the knife juggler has less immediate effect than Abusive Sergeant. Just that.
3-6. Is that 11 lethal? Damage.
Nope.
2 off.
11. Yeah.
Wow, if you didn't trade for the 2-1, would have died.
Yeah. That's a really good play from 6-0. Yeah.
So but, now Gaara has to, like. He literally has to full clear, right? To stay alive.
If he.
Yeah, he has to
full clear. It's not possible from the full clear, though. Not unless you're counting bow damage, but bow damage doesn't really count, right?
No, you're right.
It looks it does. It does if he doesn't leave a minion on because the oil needs to
get. No. It doesn't
need the oil for minion. Like
he has 8 with no creatures on board.
Right. Okay.
It looks like Gaara probably just kill the 3-1 here.
He's just playing around nothing, basically.
And just like hopefully there's no eviscerate or any other damage. Kills the Lotheb. That makes more sense. He has lethal anyways. Oh, okay.
Yeah,
it's actually a really good play because oil is kind of a liability with this thing up. There's no way to guarantee the oil on.
Yeah.
On the bot teacher, but.
Yeah, that was a really good play. Yeah.
That's 3 losses for Gaara. And 6-0 gets on the board here too. Actually, 6-0 is done. He won with his hunter against Gaara too. So that means 6-0 is done for the day, and we have a 3-3 score. Best of 11 becomes best of 5.
Between a few players from some teams here. But, yes. Zele versus Gaara mostly.
It'll be Zola team Zele versus team Gaara soon.
Is anyone benched right now?
No, but Gaara. So. Gaara is, if he plays again, will be benched.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, like...
Gaara is benched.
No, he's not. He couldn't be because he was benched earlier. Right? Oh. And Archon doesn't have 4 points.
I see.
Yeah, so there's no way anyone is benched right now. But to play Gaara, and if he loses, Hyped is basically forced to play Rogue, and that's kind of a bad spot to be in. So Temple Storm kind of played a bit recklessly with the bench system in the last round of picks, but this one is a much higher risk one, I feel.
Isn't it really weird that in this format, it's almost always one person losing a lot of games? I think if that means that if some decks are kind of weak, but a lot of times the people are losing are playing really strong decks.
Mm.
I mean, I wonder if it's just like, Hearthstone is very psychological, you know, and if you start losing, people are going on tilt or just, you know, not playing as well. Even if you think you're not going on tilt, it's, you know, it's hard to be perfectly objective on it looking at yourself. You know, you might just, just too hard to continue playing good. I don't know. Because this is happening in every single match, it seems, where it's one person losing like almost everything.
Yeah, you're right.
Isn't it? Like, every single one so far, like, all, like, five or six of them.
Yeah, I mean, that seems to be the going trend. And until now, it's typically with, like, pretty decent lineups.
Yeah.
But earlier, we had Trump lose a lot of games because of playing, I think, mid-range Paladin.
Uh-huh. Like, generally consider a weaker deck, but...
I mean, in some of the matchups, it was just clearly outclassed, I feel.
Yeah. I mean, you have to play some weaker decks in this format, I think so.
Right. But, I mean, having that player basically responsible for most of the losses is justifiable, like, right?
Yeah.
Like, if you have four premium decks and you stuck, like, you know, mid-range Paladin and, I don't know, Priest on your last player, it may not be a surprise that he loses four games before he wins two or something. But it does seem, from the limited sample size that we have, that it is maybe a little bit outside of that. But we'll see. It'll certainly be a very interesting statistic after a few more weeks. I just feel right now, not enough games have played to really realize what's going on.
Yeah. Well, we'll find out soon what happens.
Now, what would you do here if you were on Tempestorm's side? Like, they're really expecting you to play Hyped, I feel, because it's such a big risk to play Gaara. But would you just play Gaara again?
Yeah, sometimes you, because if they're expecting you not to play Gaara, then the only other option is Rogue. So you're taking a 50-50 either way, right? If you play Hyped and he only has one deck, I think it's probably something.
I believe we might see a rematch. Zele in the HTC tournament was playing the double shield block Patron Warrior, and he did lose versus Gaara's straight-up Pyromancer Control Priest.
Yeah. I mean, shield block is a bad card against Priest for Patron Warrior. You don't even have Shield Slam to really capitalize on your armor, and it's not really about staying alive, but more like being able to do strong things, you know? I guess shield block cycles, but still, I think you'd rather have some stronger stuff than shield block.
I just feel like if I'm Zele in this spot, I'm like, oh man, you know, this is what I've been waiting for. You know, like, savor over this moment.
Balrog is like MVP in this matchup in some way, but I still don't know if you keep Balrog in your opening hand with nothing else, especially going first.
I think in the prior matchup, I might be mistaken because there were a lot of Priest games because, I mean, Priest never lost in that tournament. I believe Gaara started the game with Injured Blade, like Northshire into Injured Blade.
Circle.
So he kind of like got crushed in the opener, and he was just always from behind, which is generally how you beat Patron Warrior, by the way. So I think just playing too greedy for draw might cost you the game the same way.
You might need a Mulligan for weapons.
But he has
those early minions under control. Has the Fire Rocks. Oh, Harrison Jones. I don't think you ever want to Harrison Jones a Fireworks in this matchup, though.
No. I don't even know if you want a Harrison Jones a Deathspite unless he has, like, 7 or 8 mana. Like, it's that critical. You just, like, bait out the first Deathspite. You just give him something good to kill on, like, turn 5. And then on turn 7 or 8, where it really, really matters, you steal it. All right, well, we see the Acolyte. Probably a lot of card draw is going to go down from Zele's side of the board. What's the best way to respond to this? You have two Injured Blade. That just feels a bit weak.
It's hard to play an Injured Blade Master because it's so weak to weapons. If you do play Injured Blade Master and coin with the shield, with the powered shield, you're still going to get executed at that point. It's hard to make a move, but it also feels bad to just fall behind against Patron War. What he's doing by staying a coin is like he's trying to threaten. Actually, the Shadow Menace is really good, potentially. Mm-hmm. Or threatening the Cabal on the 1-3 here, eventually.
Yeah, well, if you had a Cabal, you definitely want to save the coin, but I don't think he's going to here.
Yeah. Is there a way you can Shadow Menace? It's not great, huh? I mean, because Shadow Menace denies some of the draw, but you don't actually get to trade off anything.
Yeah, Shadow Madness is particularly terrible because not only do you steal the draw, but you actually mill yourself next turn.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
All right. So what do we have here?
I think this turn is fairly clear Balrage setup. If you attack with Fire War Axe, you'll be at 29, and with Inner Rage, two of your mains are damaged, which is perfect, I think.
So this is like the perfect draw turn?
I think so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's, although yeah, it's still only
two,
right?
Huh? Two cards.
No, it's three.
You from right? The Balrage? Oh yeah, it's yeah. Three, yeah, you're right. Three is a lot of cards to pass up.
Mm-hmm.
Will that be too many, though?
No.
That's not too many, because you'll have nine after the Balrage, and even if the Acolyte... Wait.
You'll have nine. You can get milled if the Acolyte gets hit. You can
get milled, huh? Yeah.
The real question is if Gaara draws a Pyromancer. Okay.
Do you think he's going to go for something weird? There's no way for... Oh, because you're talking about healing the Acolyte.
Yes.
Interesting. Yeah, I like it. Pyromancer, heal the Acolyte, and then go ham. But some weird way. You have a power shield.
No. If we get a power word... If he tries and gets a power word shield from the power word shield, it will be like carnage.
But how much mana is that?
Well, you can get
Power word shield the Acolyte.
Yes.
That makes sense, actually. There's a way you can kind of guarantee it where you Acolyte power... Because you can only get two explosions because your Pyromancer is going to die. If you don't Power Word Shield your Pyromancer, but you don't have mana to heal it, right? So you can do something like Pyromancer, Power Shield the Acolyte, and then like slam the Acolyte or something, you know? Which could be pretty cool.
No, it looks like he's doing the Toss Skill plane.
Yeah.
Pretty good, though. Mill, I mean, for you, one. You get the mill. Okay, that's...
Cool's all right, actually. Because it's still a whirlwind effect, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's...
I mean, this is also a tournament. Like, my play is something I would like... be tempted to do on ladder because I wouldn't care about my ranking.
Yeah. You want to go big or go home.
Exactly. But yeah, that's definitely a much more stable play.
Yeah. Plus it's kind of hard. Like, even if you're kind of thinking about it, then the rope starts coming in a tournament and then you're like, oh, no what? This is weird. If you have to play this unstable ghoul, it's one of the cards you really want to save for Emperor, because once you play Emperor, it becomes one mana, very cheap spell to combo with your frothing combos, and it's another whirlwind. It feels really bad to have to play an unstable ghoul, but I wonder if he had any other options. He didn't have any other options, huh? Mm-hmm. Unless you wanted to mill a card, which is even worse.
So. Yeah. All right. What do you have? What do you have here? A lot of nothing.
Yeah, that's why the Priestess and the Patron War is considered a very bad matchup in my perspective, because Priest a lot of times is a very reactive deck yourself, right? So you don't really do anything a lot of times if your opponent isn't doing anything. So since Patron War is not really doing anything, it's kind of like playing random things, you know, just to cycle through, it's hard for you to react to it, and eventually they're going to one-shot you. But, yeah.
Hmm.
Zalae's pretty much just looking for Emperor. It's like Emperor is all he even cares about at this point.
This is a pretty interesting play, though. Like, how do you actually deal with this?
Huh. It's interesting.
I think you have to try to proc an execute, use the execute, and then use the axe on the new one. Oh, that is interesting,
because you can't kill the patron. Like, you can't hurt it and then execute, because it'll make another patron.
Yeah.
I guess you can just kill both, execute one, death bite the other or something.
No, you have to, because you play the ghoul. That thing's not going away.
Yeah. I mean, if you have like a Ember down here, what you could actually do that'd be really funny is to just let a lot of patrons spawn so you can, you know, have a massive frothing whirlwinds. But it's in this situation it's not happening because the frothings cost too much mana. It's too much mana without the Emperor, so...
Okay.
Two cards.
It really goes for the two-card draw. It's pretty good. There's no way of you drawing another card from the board, so no chance of milling.
Yeah. I feel like Zalae's just going to have to use some of his... Because he wants a power cycle through his deck for the Emperor, so he's maybe just going to start using some of his cards as a... You know, just to be able to play them. I wouldn't be surprised if a Grim Patron plus one War Song comes down relatively soon here, just to be able to play them from his hand, force some reactions...
Mm-hmm.
you only need one Warsong for the Frothing combo at the end of the game, so the Gurn Patron Frothing is pretty expendable.
Alright, well, it just seems like a clunky turn from Gaara, and anytime you have a clunky turn, I like the Emperor. But it seems like he wants to go with the Harrison Jones. You're at 7 mana crystals, so... I can't argue with that at all.
Had to play a card here, too. Just get that Frothing out of the way. It's a very dangerous card to leave up.
Well, it's also, you don't want to overdraw, and Slam is not a very useful card.
Yeah. The other move you could make is, like, Armorsmith or something, but... It's weird, wow. You want to play out your hand here. But your hand is, like, you're just looking for Emperor, huh?
Yeah.
Maybe Shield Block?
I think you're calculating some lethal options, but I think you're pretty far still.
Not without the Emperor discount, I think, here.
But you need more Whirlwind effects or the Emperor for it to work.
I wouldn't be surprised to see, like, double Armor Smith go down or something. Maybe one in Armor Up makes more sense.
It's the thing is, though, like, Zele probably knows Gaara's deck pretty well, and he knows the liability of him dropping a Grim Patron. Because whenever you drop a Grim Patron, if he gets, like, a good Shadow Madness, like, he might end with, like, a full Grim Patron board against you.
Yeah.
Which I believe is what happened last time, by the way.
Interesting.
But I don't remember exactly.
Yeah.
It happened to someone.
It doesn't matter as much. Yeah, Patron has a very hard time clearing Patrons. So if Priest does somehow do that, then you need to kill them with Frothing after.
Well, I think if you're ever going to drop Emperor, this is the turn to do it, right?
Yeah, like a low threat board with not much to do.
I must consider.
I can't really see another move other than Emperor here. There's some options like what to heal or whether to play the Armorsmith as well. But for the most part, unless you're waiting for something in particular, like this is not a combo Priest, right? Your hand isn't great for Emperor, but
I wonder.
What are you really trying to get from Emperor? As this Priest, was that Emperor Thoughtstolen or not?
No. Okay. Emperor is just in the deck. Gaara actually runs Mind Control.
Uh-huh. That's a really good combo with Emperor.
Yeah, it is. And generally making all your stuff cheaper with Wild Pyro sets up some really crazy combos.
Does Gaara actually have the Cabal Shrinkmeister stuff in this deck as well?
I am not sure.
Because that's another thing that Emperor would make a lot better.
Gaara famously missed like a 50 damage lethal.
I saw that one.
From Shadow Menacing Zele's Warsong Commander with a Pyromancer.
Uh-huh.
So I don't think Gaara will miss that again ever in his life.
Yeah. Wow, still no patron. How many cards does Zele have left if we can get that pulled up somehow? How many cards that look like? It almost looks pretty small, that deck. 6 cards only. Every turn, there's, I don't know, like 20% chance to draw Grim Patron soon.
What now?
Is he going to use a Whirlwind here?
Wow.
Feels so bad to have to use a Whirlwind. You can tank some damage for a bit, right? How many has Lin never drawn and execute the whole game yet, or is that not right? Because... There's only 6 cards left to execute.
Yeah.
And, okay, that's decent. Cycle through more. Looks like you're not going to be able to kill Emperor. Oh, finally.
There it is.
There it is. But there's a lot of damage, and you're leaving up Emperor. Leaving up Emperor.
You need 2 turns for Emperor to really work. Like you need 1 turn to play him, then the next turn you can win. So
yeah, exactly.
It's a bit of time.
Still seems like. Gaara's probably going to lose this game, though. The Priest Emperor is not as effective, it seems.
What if we go for power milling right now? Get him into fatigue.
That makes a lot of sense.
But can you... Is that relevant, and can you do it?
Yeah, can you do it, and is it relevant? You have a Pyromancer, huh? You can Pyromancer cast 1 spell, then heal up. How many spells can you realistically cast here?
You're just missing that Circle Heal. The Circle Heal is so big.
Yeah, I think it's going to happen. Is it going to be a Thought Steal here? Oh, armor. Oh, that's really smart. Because the armor smith, it not only does it mill your opponent, it gives you a lot of armor. Mm-hmm. You need to go quick though, because this is not an easy thing to do. Oh, there's Oh yeah, double armor. Is that gonna be healed now? Oh man, this is so clutch because it feels like you're just gonna time out. What happened?
Okay. More armor is what happened.
He didn't get the heal, the backlight.
No, he, What did he heal?
He didn't heal anything, did he? Or...
Play the ghoul!
Is that good?
I don't know. He healed himself. Oh, Tara's like, I don't know, man, I don't know.
I don't know, either.
Lost
execute mill. Both executes are milled.
This game is so weird.
But executes
sometimes
don't even matter that much anymore, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, so this like, is gonna be a worse
one. If this is ever happening, it's going down right now.
It's gonna be, these turns are gonna be important. It's kind of weird that there's no Emperor, but there's a Patron turn this turn, for sure.
Oh, Light Bomb kills it, so...
Yeah. I almost feel like Zelay should have just not gone for this Patron turn, because you almost don't want to clear out the board. Like, the more minions on board, the more you're... frothing combos do with all the whirlwinds. I almost feel like it's better to play Emperor here and just try to go for the win next turn. It's a pretty complicated math turn because there's like 50 life, but I wouldn't be surprised if you can do 50 damage randomly. In fact, I think you would do 50 damage with all the Wait, how many whirlwind effects were there?
It's too many.
But there's not any whirlwinds.
Oh, what this is the easiest light bomb of your life. Yeah. Gara's like, wait, did I really want to play on a third creature? I'm not so sure about this anymore.
There hasn't been an Emperor played yet, so you might as well play more minions to pressure, because the Emperor is going to take a whole turn, I think, so maybe it makes sense to just pressure as hard as you can, because next turn is going to be the Emperor turn.
The last card is Deathsbite, though.
Mm-hmm.
So he's going to Deathsbite and Emperor here, and that's big.
Yeah, setting up everything. I'm assuming Deathsbite will be face. Yeah. Is Lay only running one unstable ghoul, that means, or what? Because I expected there to be more whirlwind effects.
This is probably enough. I think maybe Gar could have stayed alive if he suicided both his four attack
It doesn't seem blades. Like it's enough, though. Because there's only two whirlwinds, and not three or four whirlwind effects.
Yeah, but there's a lot of Grim Patience here.
That's true. I guess that it should be. We'll just have to see. There's an inner rage for some extra damage as well.
I don't know what the math on this is. It seems played like Grim Patient Warrior, enlighten us.
Yeah, it should be enough, I think.
Those frothings are pretty upset. I think it's enough.
I wonder if it's more damage to trade in one of the frothings on a minion before your whirlwind, right? Because you're gonna...
It's more damage to like trade in a Grim Patron.
Two patrons, right? You have two slots left.
Yeah.
After the whirlwind. But as you trade off, you're losing some... Oh no, there's some minions.
No, you're not. But actually, you missed some damage there, I think. Right?
I don't think so. It seems like it's lethal, though. It's lethal. Both these guys are...
Gar is like, come on! 25. I had 50 life!
Yeah. Unless the lay ropes out. Which, I think he got it, and judging by Gar's facial expression. Yeah, each one for 40. That was my prediction. I guess that was a little bit off, but...
He actually missed some damage. I think you could have hit that 2-2 and then again with a 2-3. Mm-hmm. I think you had, like, an extra, like, 3 or 4 points in there.
You can actually get 2 Frolings for 40 if you have one more roll in there, I think.
Yeah, that was actually 60 damage, yeah. Like, plus. Did you see that, Frodan? 60 damage?
I did. And I was laughing along with you.
One turn, 60 damage.
Well, more importantly, Gaara's benched again.
Yeah.
That's twice in the same series.
Gaara has given Team Archon all of their points.
Yep. Well, you know, what's really interesting, too, is that you only can be benched twice, which means Gaara is the official record holder of being benched.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, because if you get benched, you can't get benched 3 times.
No.
It's impossible in one series.
It's literally impossible, which means Hyped has to play Rogue, and you can pick the best deck you think is good against Rogue.
Mm-hmm. I think...
Or Druid, right? It's pretty close.
Yeah, actually... Like, if you win this, you still kind of maybe struggle against, like, Gaara's Priest or Hunter. Like, if you win with Warlock and you have to play Druid, then Gaara's Hunter will beat you. If you play Druid and win with that, you have to play Zoo versus that Priest.
Farbat's
probably horrible.
It's gonna be Warlock.
If there's any, like, horrifying matchup, I think it's Priest versus Zoolock, because Gaara's running double death.
Well, and Zoo is bad against Face Hunter as well. Farbat is, I think, like, I would be extremely surprised. I'm like 99% sure Arcana's going to pick Zoo.
Warlock. Yeah.
It doesn't make any sense to pick Druid at all. Like, I'm not even sure what's better, Druid or Zoo against the Rogue. I almost think that Zoo might be better than Druid anyways, and not to mention, like, the big thing is you dodge all these bad matchups, you know, because if you don't pick up a win here before taking out the Rogue, like, say Hyped wins against your Druid, right, then Rogue is gone, and now you have to win with Warlock against those two bad matchups, right? So you really want to get that win with Zoo before it becomes a liability against the Hunter and Priest.
Right. Yeah, absolutely right. But that said, Zoo is still pretty bad against Rogue.
It's not amazing.
Rogue.
Yeah. I think Rogue is probably favored against both Druid and Zoo by a little bit, mm-hmm. but I think maybe like only like 45% against both. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think it's changed a little bit with the dynamic of the Zoo deck playing so many like more sticky minions. You give the Rogue like an extra turn or two because they're not as aggressive, but they're just so hard to remove that you're constantly pushing for a threat.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Well, yeah, I think I agree a lot with what you guys are saying, too. And I think that's definitely going to be the case. Although, we could be wrong. Either way, Archon's in a pretty good spot, at least being able to get the early lead here into the midpoint of the series. We don't know yet. And in fact, I have to think that if it's taking a little bit of time to maybe switch, it probably is certainly Fireback, because the light can just kind of stay on POV anyways.
Yeah.
If we were to think a little bit outside the box there. While we have a quick second here, I'd like to remind you guys about things that make this possible. So we want to remind you guys that Alpha Draft is opening up their fantasy esports section for Hearthstone and Team League, consequently. If you guys really like watching and following Hearthstone, it makes it even more fun if you can fill out some fantasy stuff too, right? And Alpha Draft's going to be doing that really soon. You just have to check out more throughout ATLC. So quick shout out to them. I'd probably bet on Strife Crow and Crew to do better tomorrow. How do you think you're going to do tomorrow, Strife Crow? You think you got good chances?
Yeah.
You're playing?
No.
Well, according to the schedule, you'll be playing Team Liquid, which is Savitz, Nairia, and Sho.
Okay. It's nice to know.
All right. Well, I guess maybe you won't bet on Strife Crow then.
Yeah, I think I'm going to be betting all in on Team Liquid. And tomorrow we'll also have Nylum versus Team Celestial, the other four teams that we don't see featured today. Krip, are you casting tomorrow as well?
I don't know. I don't think so. But
does anybody know what they're doing? I think I have to be the one.
I am excited to cast the next match. That's what I'm doing right now.
I'm excited to play tomorrow.
All right.
No, you're not. Come on.
Yeah, I am.
The thing is, like, every time I see Schreifko playing in a tournament, I feel like he's just waking up.
Yeah. You
know? It's because every tournament is in the morning now, because they're all catered to European times. Because the most tournaments are both Europe and North America, so they're usually, you know, in the morning, and it's... I stream at night in A time, so it's, like, the worst schedule for me possible. Like, I don't get much sleep, wake up, and then I have, like, this gap in my day, like, 4 hours, where it's not enough time to do anything, but, you know, it's, like, I don't know, bad.
Pump out some YouTube videos, man. That sounds like my day, except in that free time I make YouTube videos.
Yeah, sounds fun.
Wow. It take a hot steaming dump on Crip's life. Well, it's okay, Crip. I like your videos. I especially really like the one where you got Ben Brode to answer. That was real tight stuff, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, here we go. Warlock versus Rogue, just as predicted. This is an important turning point for the series. If Hype can win, then it's just Agara versus the World Show match. Kind of like kind of like what we saw Trump did in the previous series.
Mm-hmm. Well, I actually like that hand. I don't know why the juggler had to leave. Why did the juggler have to leave?
It's weak to removal as Rogue. Normally, in this matchup, you want to go for a sticky hand. Death Rattles, Void Terror Egg is kind of like the dream. And you can't really move, like...
Wow.
Looking at Flame Imp, right? So...
That looks like the dream to me.
Yeah, it looks like the dream to me.
Turn 2 Egg, turn 3 Power Bomb, Egg, Void Terror.
Yeah.
That's the dream. Unfortunately, there's Zap, but still, that's the dream. Because you have the Flame Imp here, too.
You can't even deal with the Flame Imp.
And not unless you double attack it. It's impossible that he's going to go for that. Because you do have Earthen Ring to heal, but...
Yeah. I think that's actually the play, because you know there's another threat coming out next turn, so... Like, you need the Earthen Ring to deal with that threat. If you don't attack it, you're always behind on the board. What's that?
What if a Voidwalker comes out and you attack? It'd be a disaster.
A sad face.
Yeah, sad face. Wow. Oh, now you have double Egg, a Void Terror. Oh, man, that is weird.
Yeah, that's like... It feels like a little slow now, though.
Faster move, huh? Yeah, it seems... I wouldn't be surprised if it's just next turn... The Power Roaming coin, Void Terror. It seems like the double egg is too slow, but it does make sense as well.
All right.
Well, picks up Blade Flurry. That's going to be a really important card. I think he still go for the Farseer, right?
Yeah. Oh no, is he thinking of sapping?
Sapping here would be super weird.
If like, what would you sap if you sap anything? The Flame Imp, I guess.
Flame? I don't know. I was thinking sap the egg, but if you are going to sap
If you sap the egg, you have, like, I don't, like, a cataclysm your way, you know? It's over. It's going to be, like, coin double egg into Power Overwhelm, Void Terror, both eggs. Like, never want to play Hearthstone again after that.
Same thing, though. Just do Egg and Flame Imp next turn. I can't imagine a non-Earthen Ring move here. The problem with Earthen Ring is you're scared of it being the Egg Activator, right? Due to Abusive.
Mm-hmm. Or in this case, Power Overwhelming. And you get the coin Void Terror.
Mm-hmm. I think the Defender of Argus made it super easy. Because now you have no... Like, you know, you're not going to be baited to play the second Egg here. You can just use the Argus to activate the second Egg.
Yeah. And Hype is committed to sap. Oh, that's a great draw, though.
Yeah, that's good. If you want to clear the 7-6, you're still going to have to take the 7 face, and you can't clear the 4-4.
What if you just equip Deadly Poison, sap, and pass?
That I feel like that's the move that makes the most sense, but I wouldn't be surprised if it was another move. I mean, you can do Deadly SI and kill a 3-2. You can also play Shredder. Shredder seems worse than the SI.
Yeah, because then you get to... Because the Flame Imp can trade directly into the Shredder. That feels really weak, too. I mean, he does have Deadly Poison and Blade Flurry, so if the boy ever gets too crazy, he still has that stabilization point.
Mm-hmm. It's just if you want to kill this Flame Imp. I think you don't.
I would. Seems like you have Blade Flurry, huh? But your next turns don't seem to be Blade Flurry turns.
Why not?
Blade Although Flurry, if you save your Blade Flurry, you can play Blade Flurry and Assign. Yeah.
Yeah. Which would have worked out pretty well. You could Blade Flurry. No, you could attack like the Void Caller, Blade Flurry, and then SI the 4/4. And you know what's in his hand, so.
Okay. Yeah, so at least if he has a Void Void Terror and something else, like maybe he can pull out that instead of the big threat, but still, like, this Void Caller is really really annoying to deal with.
Yeah, I feel like if Firebat draws next turn a big demon, the game is instantly completely over. Because he's going to egg and Void Terror the Void Caller.
I wouldn't be surprised if this is just the clear here with Blood Mage. And hope that... Okay, so he knows there's a Void Terror, huh? But Void Terror coming out isn't the worst. Because yeah, any okay. minion you play is just dropping into food, so it's not like they're committing more, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
Because unless he's super... Play around the Blood
unless
Flurry
he's super training. YOLO and just goes Azure Drake.
That's really good. That helps so much. Yeah. Like, think of how bad it would have been if he didn't get rid of the... Not only the board, but also the Void Terror from the hand.
Yeah.
All right, well, is this still looking really good for the Zoo player, or do you think Rogue can start turning it back?
I think it looks good for Zoo with two Arcuses here and the egg still. Fireback, or Hype can start getting stuff going here finally, though, but...
Yeah, I mean,
double
right now...
SI is really weak to Argus because you have a 3-5 into the... I mean, yeah, the 3-5 imp gang killing your SIs. Yeah. But then the Azure Drake move is...
What about Shredder into Eviscerate? Yeah.
Leaves the 3-2 challenges the Shredder, but it is much better against Defender of Argus, because the also important thing is that the 1-1 will be in the middle, so... It's not like he can do a significant buff.
Exactly. I like that the most, I feel. I wouldn't be surprised if he's after Drake here, but it feels worse than Shredder of History. The double SI move is just like a 100% loss if you get Argus. So.
Mm. Yep, fair enough.
This is smart by leaving up this guy instead.
Yeah, I guess it gives him less room to work with on the board because it gets challenged. Assuming he had just more minions to pile on, then the Shredder could kill off the Imp Gang boss.
Yeah.
But not in this case.
He does get punished by the Argus, though. It would have been good either way. It's not like he had a great...
Really hard to deal with. That's the better juggle, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Wow, I actually want to face you.
Okay.
He didn't want the Doomsayer because he knew that was coming.
Good call. But it can still come.
Yeah, and there's already a good sap target, so you don't have to be worried about sap on your gang as much, right? Because this way you're weak to sap by not trading, but there's still a sap on egg, which would have been very strong as well. Backstab's always a nice card to get. I
wonder. Yeah.
Here.
Is there anything that can like come out of the Shredder that can help you if you want to be trying to fight for the board, like a spell power thing or...
Yeah.
I don't know. Pretty much only the Gold Ball Geomancer, right?
Yeah.
No.
Seems like the best would be Explosive Sheep.
Blood Mage. Yeah, Explosive
Sheep. Oh, Explosive Sheep. Yeah.
Because Doomsayer...
Yeah, maybe your own Doomsayer.
If there's more than 7 damage left on board.
He's gonna kill the 4/4 here. This guy's toast. That's nice.
I really like that move. That's a hard turn to make that like a call. That seemed like far better than anything I was thinking of. Just because any attack you like, it's so hard to ever attack anything due to the egg here, and there was not any great SI targets. You know, like the backstab double SI was much stronger than the Azure Drake move, but there was what wasn't a great way to backstab double SI unless you kill the Nerubian.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, I'm feeling an implosion here. Or yeah, you implosion could just pop up big time.
I think both options are all right.
So since you're not killing your opponent anyway this turn, it's probably better to just implosion something.
He might be thinking of Phantom Knives and implosioning after the Phantom Knives here because your Imp Gang boss is going to generate a lot of 1-1s anyways, right? So if you can bait out a Phantom Knives this turn because you're going to have at least 2 1-1s from the Imp Gang boss, then you can implosion next turn and play around the AoE like that or Blood Flurry. Seems like just all face.
Just go face.
The 3-4 might trade, I'm not sure, but all face makes more sense. And then here, like, you know, if there was
right
an AoE, it would go down this turn, then you can implosion next turn.
I think what would be the best draw is off this Azure Drake sap to help deal with the Imp Gang boss. And
yeah, no, it has to be exactly sap. There's like, is there any other card that deals with it? I don't think so.
Maybe if he gets... yeah, I think it has to be that.
Okay, well, that's maybe second best, but second best... I guess you stay alive. Yeah, you stay alive here. Shredder and 3-3 into the 4-6, eviscerate the 3-4, 3-3 into the 2-3, and your opponent's threatening 4 damage, and you're at 6.
Well, you actually even might get a spell power off of this. Pretty cool.
Oh, that's true. If you get a spell power off of this.
Oh, yeah, that would have been insane.
Yeah. You can also get a Lore Walker Cho and you lose the game on the spot.
Strifegirl, what are you doing to us?
Wow. No,
I thought
always,
for sure it was going
to
happen.
I like to play the risky way, right? Because you're so far behind. I like playing for the spell power.
That's wow. Boys.
Probably.
Lethal boys. He's gotta cash in, hit 2 to the face.
It's gonna be 4, but then it's gonna like clear the board and not. Like,
oh.
Miss.
Oh, miss. Oh no lethal.
No lethal. Oh wait, no, it can still be lethal. It can still be lethal.
Oh.
Oh no, it can't because he can't play it. He can't play another creature.
No mana.
That crit fake out.
Well.
Oh, it's not useful at all. Well, looks like Archon's up 5-3 over Tempest Storm.
The important thing is the zoo gets to dodge the bad matchups pretty
soon. Yep, exactly. And now Tempest Storm's in the same exact position as they were last week, where they have to beat Druid 3 times
again,
in a row to win.
Again.
Yep.
Yeah. It's possible, though. I mean, Druid is one of those decks that kind of loses to itself. I feel like the Gaara's Priest deck is a bit too passive to really expect to win. But we'll see. Maybe it is like... Did we see the Druid, actually? I don't think we saw the Druid.
I don't believe so. I think just kept showing up with Warrior.
Okay. Yeah, well, maybe it's like a really... really rampy Druid. I think a really rampy Druid is fairly likely to lose to all 3.
Maybe it's okay against Facehugger, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's certainly bad against Rogue. Sap is too much of a tempo swing against things like Ancient of War, especially since they're probably going to be ahead of you. So when you do get Sap, you're like taking 10 damage or something from the board. So.
I also I want to mention that in the last time we saw Archon play, Zele was the remaining player that could not grab the final few wins and ended up dropping the series. So it would really suck if he's in that spot again, if Tempo Storm is able to come back here. All the glory gained by Tempo Storm will come out of Zele's sanity.
Mm. All right, well, here
hopefully,
we go. Rogue versus Druid.
For their sake, he gets some nice hands. Druid is known for being really volatile as far as opening hands go.
Yeah. Well, up against Rogue specifically, I know a lot of Rogue players feel very good in this matchup, but Druid players have generally gotten the better edge of Rogue, even though people feel like Rogue might be pretty decent against Druid.
This is interesting. This Druid hand in particular, like, if you actually just keep everything, even though no Innervate or Wall of Growth, or, you know, what you would do here.
I don't think you really need it. Like, I don't think Druid the Claw is that important in this match. So I think at the very least you drop that.
Yeah. And also you have a lot of 5 drops, right? So even if you do Mold and Druid the Claw, you'll probably get another 5 drop before turn 5. And it gives you a better chance of getting Wild Growth and Innervate. That makes a lot of sense. Is Lay even Mulligan the Shredder?
Yeah, he wants Wild Growth that early. Oh, there it is!
Got it.
Although, it still makes it that he's going to play Shade, right? Instead of the Keeper, there's nothing on board. After
yeah.
The line. Yeah. But that's still fine.
But he is going to be able to play Azure Drake.
One turn earlier.
Yeah.
No. Okay. Well, if Keeper does have a target, it could be Keeper into Drake into double Shade, perhaps, which would get totally destroyed, but hey.
Yeah, the thing about it is that Rogue can seize back tempo, too, because of prep, so even though Druid can get ahead in Wild Growth, and it keeps it very competitive in this game, Rogue can easily take it away from Druid. But that's where cards like Harrison Jones really come as a big key factor, if he has it or not. Because then Rogue can camp on Blade Flurry for a long time. They can just sit with a big weapon, and Druid can't do anything.
The double poison Blade Flurry is going to be a huge comeback potential here, especially if these shades start hiding for multiple turns. And then, like, say, you know, there's 2 shades, then the third main gets all Blade Flurried. The problem is, I think, like, Hyped... he really wanted to hit minions. He didn't hit that many minions, especially with the coin. You want to go for double 4 drops in against Druid. Like, it's so much better for you as a rogue to say coin out a Shredder and then Vlad Teacher, or even the other way around. Whereas if you're playing like reactive from behind against Druid, that's where your problems are mostly come from. Like, you can take too much damage being a little far behind, and then. Yeah, you're just in combo range at that point, but
yeah,
unless you fight really hard for board control. Yeah, but Hype's you know, major thing here is he does have the double deadly Blade Flurry. He has to decide which 5 drop to play.
Yeah, he has to play a creature.
Azure Drake gets challenged just by the Druid the Claw too, so. Lotheb is a little bit more resilient. Ooh, he's equipping a deadly poison. It's flurrying now.
Oh, interesting.
Okay. Well, he doesn't know that there's 2 shades. So
oh, like, that's really good, actually. He gets to save his 3/3 this way. Yeah.
Okay. And he saves the coin, and he has he still has some mana flexibility because he has coin and prep.
Yeah.
So if he picks up Eviscerate, whatever his opponent drops out next, he can definitely answer it.
I would be surprised if there's doesn't get Keeper.
Yeah.
Because this is like a perfect for mana, perfect target for Keeper. There's not a lot, like, you know, unless they're wearing Van Cleef, there's not a lot of targets for Keeper anyways to silence. And leaving up Rogue mains is always dangerous because
the Tinker Oil possibility.
Yeah, Tinker Oil saps like a just removal, like Eviscerate. If you just keep dropping minions into their board, you can just take damage every turn from their minion. Lotheb on their Druid turn 7 is like almost the worst turn, since turn 7 is normally when the Dr. Boom range and lore comes out, so Lotheb doesn't really have an effect there.
Yeah, it also gets better after those turns too, significantly, if your opponent's trying to
combo.
Yeah, yeah, posture for a lethal.
Yeah.
Lotheb can shut down those plays.
You do want to make as strong of a move as possible, generally. Lotheb is stronger than Drake.
Yeah. You just start pushing.
Okay, so it does play it here. It's just like hard because there's a lot of 7 drops for Druid. Ooh.
Harrison comes in is very helpful. Not right now, though. just as if Rogue ends up building up things like oil and deadly poison sitting there, that's going to be really nice.
Yeah, and he already used one blade flurry. There's another one in the deck, but without having to draw it yet, he's probably going to end up in that situation. Well,
Anything you put out gets challenged by Lothar pretty easily.
Yeah.
Well, outside the shade, but that's really inefficient.
I think the Belcher is pretty decent here. You leave the Lothar about 2 life, and you can just Savage Roar defensively. Your hero for 2 damage can kill the Lothar. You'll have 4 damage on the board from the Keeper, another 3 from the Ooze Remainder, and you can Azure Drake on that turn if you need.
I think the Azure Drake definitely wants to start picking up other steam as the game develops, so I think it's nice to have it later on. But having the Savage Roar and using it defensively is probably not as big of a priority compared to using it to threaten to kill. Because the Druid needs to pressure Rogue, otherwise Rogue just sees too much tempo.
The sap draw is huge. Now you can sap and have a 9-point damage on board. The Keeper isn't really doing anything here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you have ways to deal with Sludge Belcher if it's replayed next turn, kind of. Definitely I would see sap go face, start pressuring a lot here. A 9 damage lead is really when, this kind of lead is really when Rogue shines, because it's so hard to drop minions into Rogue minions, right? Because Rogue has a really good removal. Normally when you drop minions, they just get removed.
Yeah.
And
but at this stage, is that still the case in this game with one Blade Flurry down?
I mean, there's still second sap. There's still Eviscerates and prepped. Eviscerates and Deadly Poisons. I mean, we know that Hype doesn't actually have that many cards that kill minions, but he doesn't know that. And I don't know. I mean, there's not much he can do here other than just try and drop minions again, but it's normally not the position you want to be in.
Yeah, he's going to drop Shade as well. And Hype does have options to dig with Prep Sprint or whatever he wants to do. Farseer even healing for tempo would be pretty nuts too.
Blade Flurry number 2. It's scary as well.
Blade Flurry number 2 would be crazy if you could pick that up.
I think you have a lot of half combos, and I think this is usually a point in the game where you want to sprint.
The problem is I think Hype is counting lethal for Zalae, because turn 9 Druid combo, it's likely that you die here as well. Say you don't heal at all, you just kill the Belcher and the Slime, you leave up both those minions, you do die to combo. That's 21 exactly, right?
I believe that's
23
would be it. He can heal out of it
with the Earthen Ring. I think you prep sprint, and then if you miss, then you Earthen Ring to 24.
Yeah, Earthen Ring yourself here too, and equipping the weapons also. Or actually even Heal Boss, since you can use your mana more efficiently this way. It's fine.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay, and he might try to do a power play with Sprint next turn. Wow, double Savage Roar.
Yeah, it's only 17 damage, though.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't be surprised if Harrison comes down here for card draw, even though you're not getting... oftentimes you do get one shot by the Blade Flurry. It's not like you ever catch the oil, you know? It's just like all the Blade Flurry together, and you have 2 chance draw for swipe here instead of 1 with Dagger Drake. Although without the spell power, it's not as good.
Wild Growth not helpful at all.
That's a big miss.
Should he start trading in, cashing the Shade on the Drake? And
yeah, I think so.
Yeah, the alternative, he can actually board through with 1 Savage Roar.
1 Savage Roar, right? I wouldn't be surprised to see a Savage Roar here. You have 2. And without Emperor, you can't double combo with Force of Nature. You're probably going to lose your board next turn, too, with Savage Roars. If it does set a board clear.
Mm-hmm.
Playing defensive.
Thalnos. Hyped, now that he sees Harrison... knows he can't die to a combo. 1 Savage Roar has been used. I think he can also set up to potentially go for kills soon, because he has 12 damage with the weapons.
Yeah, he's really close, but he just needs more cards. I think he has to sprint. Like, no matter what, you have to sprint here.
Yep. You also just Farseer afterwards, or you can see what you get too. Viscerate helps you get some tempo on the Arison.
You can clear. You can clear.
Yeah.
That's interesting, because of the spell power in Fana Knives. It allows him to do something like Blood Mage Backstab Fan.
Yeah.
He doesn't even need to use the prep, actually.
Yeah, he does.
Unless he wants... Oh, yeah, he does.
Yeah, but then he sets up a weapon, too, for next turn, which even is more convenient for the kill.
Yeah.
That second prep draw was nuts.
Yeah.
There it is. Blurry.
Second blade. That was really important.
This attack was also good too, so that way when Druid hero powers down, you can have 12 damage with the deadly poison oil blade flurry combination.
Right, exactly.
Well, the only way to survive for Zalay is to heal himself, right? Unless you can pick up something with that.
Yeah, unless you top deck something, you're the only way that we know, it's because we see a hand, is hero power plus ancient lore to heal.
Or wild growth into a draw. Mm-hmm.
Well, you might be able to top deck a taunt like the other druid.
True. Or a sludge belcher. I don't know if it's run in the deck or not, but.
Oh, I played one earlier, so.
Didn't okay.
Yeah, druids sometimes have this weird carousel of five drops, though, of like two druid claws and one of everything else.
I guess that means that he's dead.
I guess he's dead.
Yeah. It was a good try, but this is again a matchup that a lot of rogue players seem they like it. So it doesn't necessarily surprise a lot of the rogue specialists that hyped able to take this match. Yeah. And Archon still has a lot of breathing room. You have druid against priest and druid against hunter. So you can try again, even though those matchups maybe not be the best. We'll see.
Zele's making that face. Yep.
When this is going.
Yeah.
Well, Depo Storm's showing some life. 5-4. You think we're going to game 11, possibly?
It's
possible.
Will Gaara
not get a win today?
Gaara is hosting the Hunter, I believe. I think Face Hunter versus Druid is usually pretty easy for the Hunter, if I'm not mistaken.
Double game 11s. The last series went down to game 11, too.
It's really going to go down, I think, to Priest versus Druid. And, well, I just feel the priest needs to draw well and the druid needs to draw kind of badly for the priest to win. Because if the druid starts winning from the start, the priest has like no chance. And if
druid is too robust, like you just keep, you don't run out of cards with all the ancient lores and the Azure Drakes keep going.
But if it is the case that both players draw badly, I think the druid's going to win for sure, because you're just going to draw into like a super combo. You can never play the game as a priest to always be above like 22. It's just impossible. So, it's going to be a really tough one for Gaara to win for Tempo Storm, but certainly not impossible.
All right. Druid versus Hunter seems very logical progression here.
You have to get those points. First. Yeah, even if you lose, it's important to get as many wins as possible.
Yeah, so you want to pick the better deck first.
Right.
For tiebreakers.
Now this is a matchup that I very rarely see go with Druid. You think it's Druid favored?
Against Face Hunter. Against mid-range it's more closer, but against Face it's definitely Druid favored, I think.
Wow. I thought it was the exact opposite. I thought it was definitely Hunter favored.
Well, it's the fact that Druid can race really well Hunter.
Yes, dump ancient allure though.
But are you saying, oh my god, to the hand, to druid. The sunglasses?
The druid hand.
Yeah.
There's 100% sure you dump ancient allure against Face Hunter. You can't go that greedy. Even with the ramp.
It doesn't have a red X on it yet, so.
I would be surprised if you pull off something like this.
Yeah.
Turn one leper now and turn two mad scientist, and you're really trying to go for the ancient allure.
Yeah, you're just going to have to like innervate, heal yourself. I mean, you could have just played another minion and fought back for board control anyways.
Yeah.
Again, there's no X on it.
Yeah,
so.
I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if he even dumped wall growth with an innervate.
Oh, he did that.
Yeah, you, I guess it's actually guess, a really good
oh,
point.
Oh, you got, oh, got wait, you got a second one.
Wow.
Big Game Hunter's not that helpful either.
I think I just saw a small smile from Gara. I think he knows. Gara knows, guys. Gara always knows.
Yeah. Well, I think he's smiling because he's playing Hunter.
Okay.
In the zone.
Yeah, now if Gara plays the Knight... Oh, wait, hold on. He's got double.
Oh, that's so good. Because if you don't want to play Knife Juggler here, straight into the Keeper turn, right? This is straight into the Keeper turn.
Right.
We know he didn't have it, but it really feels bad.
Oh.
That's a clear.
It is a board clear, you're right. Spend two cards to kill two cards.
In fact, he's going to have to do it. It's so weird because you want to acquire Ancient Lore because you need to cycle through your deck. You don't have all your hand is so like reactive, you know, with the BGH and the Savage Roar left with this hand. But I think you still have to do it. It's just too much damage to pass up. You can't really play BGH and expect a trade for the 4/4 either because of 2/1.
Right. Okay.
Huffer. It's a Huffer. Gara
knows. This turn, I feel like it's more likely to maybe be Knife Juggler and Leper Gnome.
Mm-hmm. That helps you space your mana, so that way you can start weaving in hero powers too. And you're less like all in on the Animal Companion, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
You mean on the Huffer?
Yeah.
On the Huffer Companion? Yeah, I like this too. I agree. Splitting it. Next turn you can Knife Juggler Hero Power or Knife Juggler's Explosive, depends on what you're feeling, and then Animal Companion Hero Power.
Well, Growth's actually kind of nice.
Yeah, but you basically trade Wild Growth for Big Game, and you have to play Big Game.
I guess you can't, yeah. Still have the Big Game and Hero Power, right?
What about Savage Roaring down the Knife Juggler? Is that worth keeping? Because Savage Roar is one of your keys to actually win against Face Hunter.
Yeah.
Because you need a race eventually at one point.
I guess he's doing it.
Yeah.
Mm. So he's really dependent on this Ancient Lord doing big things.
He's the way Zlay is playing, he has to out heal and out taunt, right? Because he's both the Savage Roars and his Force of Nature. But it's just a nature of what was his hand. Because he had all those cards from early. Yeah. So he didn't really have a choice. Feels so bad to drop Ancient Lore here into this.
That's a nice card.
Nice top deck. Yeah.
I think
it
can't
feel good to drop Ancient Lore into this board. And not
do you
deal
think
with
the
it.
Charge is actually maybe better than the taunt?
It's definitely something to think about. I'm not sure.
Oh, it is for him. Mm-hmm. So he can clear the board.
Yeah. Knife Juggler is pretty scary. Not completely sure. Like, say it gets removed by like Hunter's Mark, especially,
right?
Or something like even like a kill command plus something else on a juggler, then you know you can't deal with the Knife Juggler at 12. Yeah, so
that's still a lot of damage because kill command and explosive trap is still 7 if you compare that with Animal Companion.
Yeah.
So he's getting very close. Might
I think you have to Lothab here?
Yeah.
Because at this point, your Ancient Lore is going to be for healing. Yep. So if you play Ancient Lore this turn, like you shouldn't die next turn, especially if you play Lothab. So you can Lothab and Hero Power face and the Ancient Lore and Hero Power. So you weave in the extra armor and extra damage. Whereas if you play Ancient Lore this turn, I guess you can play Lothab and BGH.
I think Lothab BGH will probably shorten the game by one turn, which is 2 damage.
Yeah, you don't have the Hero Power, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, is it a race?
Is he going face?
Oh, no. Okay. I almost...
There's no way.
He doesn't even have the Savage Roar anymore.
Wow. Look at that power.
Gara has a pretty good turn here.
Sick.
Lothab MVP. Okay, I wonder if Drew can pull it through to the healing here.
Dude, that's 16. 9 damage this turn, or 10 damage this turn.
10 damage this turn, you're at 16. It actually 20, looks pretty good. Although,
15 next Gara turn.
Has a lot of damage.
So he needs to pick up 4 more damage next turn, or 5 more damage next turn. And then he will have an opportunity to lethal. Second Savage Roar, second Force of Nature. That's about
swipe.
It. No, Swipe would be one short because he has 15 next turn.
Oh!
Okay. Okay, that's angle. Smart too, to cut down some of the damage with the big game. Yep.
Or King Golem's like a free thing here. The one mana is useless when they're on 10 already, so. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Oh my goodness.
That probably saved him. It looked like Zlay was going to die.
Is he still might be in trouble?
No, not at 14, I think.
Huffer, Kill Command, and
there's no mana to do a quick shot in Hero Power 2.
Okay.
I think you Hero Power here.
It's one off with Huffer.
4, 9, 12.
Two off with Huffer?
Two off now, yeah.
So he quick shots defensively and Kill Commands defensively. And then here,
yeah.
So animal companion first.
I guess you have
to. As long as it's not Leoc, it's fine. Actually, if it's Huffer, you could go face.
But you still have to kill two of the minions.
Yeah, with spells.
Yeah, say Huffer, you go face, then you still have to kill command two of the minions.
Yes, I think Huffer's the best as a result of that.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of stinks too is that because you have this abusive sergeant, you can't actually draw off the quick shot because it costs 8-9 mana total to play everything.
Yeah. If you do that, you can't win. It seems not like it's not even, it's almost seems impossible to win if you waste all your spells. And you have to though.
Okay, so he's not going to play Animal Companion this turn.
Get the extra hero power in.
Yeah. That's he feels like his best chance.
Yeah.
How does that work?
No, worst draw. So he's gonna rely on the second kill command here.
Do you think the Shade is being played here? Does it unleash the hounds?
There's no need to. The game would be. Oh, well, actually, there it would be if you remove the Ancient of Lore and the.
Exactly. Shade. You definitely have to think about it.
He's thinking about what 3-card combo with unleash to kill him.
I can't think of one.
Okay, well, it's basically has to be Huffer and has to be Kill Command off the top. Specifically in that order.
Ooh, that's damage.
Oh, wait. Amisha?
That's
maybe?
Amisha. Oh, wow. Oh.
That doesn't save you. Oh, you can trade.
Yeah, you can trade.
Oh, you're going to win the minion battle. Oh, no, not really, actually, because hero power. I was thinking if you win the minion battle because of the innervate, like say it's a blank. Oh, there's no such thing as a blank.
Wow.
No! Oh, that's it.
And that is a top deck war. Team Archon takes the series 6-4. And Gaara. Well, Gaara's one sad camper today, let me tell you.
How many games did Gaara lose?
He lost
5?
Yes, because Hype lost one. So Gaara went 0-5 today. Wow. And
Gaara went 0-5.
That's a new record, I believe. Because Trump at least went 2-6, I think, today for Team Value Town.
Wait, how can you go 2-6?
It's not possible to go 2-6. Because the moment you lose 6, you lose. And the moment you win 2, you can't play again.
Yeah, I think about 1-6.
It's
really a debate of is 1-6 worse than 0-5? win percentage-wise, it's better. Worse to go 0-5.
Right? It's better.
Yeah, I guess at least 0-5, they were still not completely your fault. 1-6, it's like you lost every single match for your team. I don't know. I guess it's debatable. Either way, not the best results for Trump and Gaara as Team Archon takes the second match. They are 1-1 and Tempo Storm falls to 0-2. They at least won 4 games for their tiebreaker score, but that comes to the conclusion of today. How'd you enjoy that match, Rifebro?
It was fun. I enjoyed casting today. And it was this close series.
It was a very close series.
Gotcha. Yep. Crip?
I was just going to mention, I was going to chime in there that I believe because Archon only lost by 1 point in their opening match and is 2 points ahead in this one, they're in the green.
Yeah, they're in the green. But, I mean, every team is... You know, like in the yellow, except for the eighth place team. So as long as one team is like getting a couple of wins here and there, it's not totally over. Tempo Storm could easily be like 6th or 7th place and still make to the finals. Or hypothetically speaking, we could have, you know, other people be fighting over and Tempo Storm never wins a single game from this point on. They get 8th place.
Yeah.
We'll see. We'll see. I want to remind you guys that the placings are as follows. We'll have the 1st and 2nd team go to directly to the live finals in phase 3. Teams 3 through 5, as well as the winner of 6 and 7, will end up playing for phase 2 for those playoff spots. And that'll be happening all over the next couple of months. Make sure to check out teamarcon.com/league. Mm-hmm. Trip myself up over there. Final words, guys, before we send it off and get ready for tomorrow's broadcast?
I just want to say, hope you guys enjoyed watching. It's great to cast you guys. And believe the league will continue tomorrow. If you guys want to see Cloud9 versus Team Liquid and Nihilim versus Celestial, you guys should check it out then.
That's right. Want to give a big shout out once again to Strifeco for coming on, as well as RDU for player casters. And we can expect more of that in the future. I think three-man... We needed to get used to it, but I think it worked out pretty well. So I'm glad we were able to dip into that today. From Frode and Crip, Strifeco, and everyone here at the production crew, thanks so much for watching. We'll see you guys tomorrow at 10 a.m. Pacific here at Maz's channel. So make sure to hit the follow button. Until then, have a good night and good luck on ladder.